Right now at Safeway, save on all your favorite home scents and cleaning products for a fresh, clean home. Shop for deals on items like Glade candles and plug-ins, Febreze air fresheners, Clorox cleaners, Swiffer wet cloths, or Scotch-Brite sponges. Plus, deck the halls and shop for deals on items like mini light sets, holiday wrapping paper, holiday candles, and holiday cards. Offer expires December 26th. Restrictions apply. Promotions may vary. Visit Safeway.com for full offer details.
Get great deals throughout the store at Safeway. This week at Safeway, get mega packs of bone-in USDA choice beef New York strip steaks for $5.97 per pound with digital coupon. Limit two packages. Plus, Haas avocados are 10 for $10, member price. Also, this week at Safeway, mix or match 12 packs of 12-ounce cans or 8 packs of 12-ounce bottles of Coca-Cola, Pepsi, 7-Up, or Dr. Pepper are buy two, get three free. Limit three free items, member price plus CRV. Visit Safeway.com or head in store for more deals.
Welcome, friends. It's the Movie Boom Podcast. Enjoy the show. Jackie and Brian are talking about the Movie Boom Podcast on the radio.
Welcome to a movie film commentary track. My name is Zaki Hassan, and I'm here with Brian Hall, about to take the red pill.
Let's go down the rabbit hole, Zaki.
Oh, the Matrix has you, Brian.
Whatever. Yep. And I welcome the Matrix.
I welcome our machine overlords.
Yeah, I'd rather not wake up in a puddle of goo, tubes stuck to my abdomen.
Yeah, coming in and out of your hindquarters.
Yeah, yeah. Or, I don't know, maybe that's a discussion we can have. Would we want to wake up or not?
I expect that is a conversation we will have, and in case you didn't know what the topic of this show was when you downloaded it, having read the topic on the description, we're here to talk about The Matrix, which celebrates its 20th anniversary this month.
Wow. Yeah, and that was, we'll get into it, but that was a very memorable theater-going experience for sure for Brian. So, looking forward to
plugging back in. This is going to be fun. Well, there is only one cut of The Matrix. We have lots to talk about. And so rather than spend time on a lot of preamble, I figure let's just get into it. We are queued up. Yeah. I'm ready to go on my end. Brian, you're ready?
I'm ready.
So, folks, if you want to watch along with us, please feel free. If you don't want to watch along with us, hopefully we can keep the ride engaging as we go through this journey. This really will be kind of a time machine journey for us. Okay, so here we go. I'm ready to go. So we will play on three. One, two, three, play. So one, two, three, play.
Boom.
And we were watching this on mute, but I can hear this music.
Yes.
As the Warner Brothers logo comes up.
You know, I was telling Zaki that before we got on the air here, as I was making my coffee, I hear these horns. I don't know if you call them dissonant horns, but yeah, I mean, this is funny. I mean, something I wanted to get into is The Matrix came out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And now it's one of those things that everyone knows. And it doesn't have like a score you can hum, but you can hear it in your head.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Like everything about this movie made an impression and stuck.
It really did. And the music, while we're talking about it, Don Davis did the music for all three films. Mm-hmm. And he definitely gave them a unique identity.
Yeah.
Now, as we get into it, I think what's really worth appreciating, I mean, nowadays, when we talk about The Matrix, you know, people sort of know what The Matrix is. Oh, it's the machines that created the, program reality and blah, blah, blah. But what the thing that worked most in favor of the film was the complete ambiguity. Nobody knew what the movie was about, and that was the selling point.
Yeah, yeah. All I remember was, what is The Matrix?
Yes.
Right? That was the name of the webpage, if I remember correctly.
That was the website.
It was thematrix.com.
And in the trailers, what I most remember is they had the line from the film where Lawrence Fishburne, as Morpheus, says, unfortunately, nobody can be told what the Matrix is. You have to see it for yourself, as we're watching like Keanu and Bullet Time, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, so I mean, I don't recall even really being super amped for this movie. I just think it looked like something that could be cool that was coming out shortly before Star Wars Episode One. it was like to hold me over, right? And then it just blew my mind, and it became something we still remember 20 years from now.
And one, you know, this opening sequence here we're watching with Carrie Ann Moss's Trinity being, you know, caught by the police. The value of storyboarding your shots is really put in play, because you have these compositions that, you know, the storyboards for this movie were done by comic book artists Steve Skros, Jeff Darrow, and you really, I mean, the Wachowskis came from comic books, having written for Marvel in the early part of the 90s. So there's a comic book sensibility, not only to the story, but to the storytelling and the framing and everything else. And I think, obviously, for me, that really jumped out at me very early on. I was like, oh, this is a superhero movie.
Yeah. And it's one of those movies, too, where it is so precise in its framing and in the way that the action is captured. And even, like, I mean, just look at these shots with him turning his head around. I mean, it's so, and it feels like, you know, so many, well, we should talk about this sequence here. I mean, this is the
look at that shot right there.
Had us hooked from the beginning, where they're trying to capture Trinity.
This is the first bullet time, dare I say, ever?
Not ever. I think, remember a Gap commercial had it before this, but it was, I actually looked that up. I think it goes back as far as 93.
Okay.
But it was people like figuring it out.
Okay.
And this movie actually innovated it. They were finding ways to push it for their needs. So, I mean, these guys definitely, well, I would say these guys definitely shoved it into the zeitgeist. And then after this, you couldn't escape it.
And then people just killed it dead after The Matrix.
Yeah. Like the one that I always think of is Charlie's Angels.
Yes.
You know, which is a fun movie, and it's supposed to be like a heightened reality, but it was like they were doing all this weird wire foo, you know, kind of stuff that made zero sense. But it was like, well, hey, you know, everyone wants to watch The Matrix again.
That's an appropriation of the storytelling tropes in this film without recognizing the significance that they played within the world of the film.
Yes. Yes. I mean, yes, it's all part of the story why all this stuff is happening. That's why it's so great. But yeah, this thing is so, I mean, it's almost like a music video. It's so precise. But you know what? It's funny is this movie doesn't feel sterile either.
No.
As precise as it is.
That's a really good point, you know? I mean, it's got a beating heart underneath it.
Yeah, and even this action, like, it doesn't feel like rote and robotic. You know what I mean?
That is appropriate given what the film is about, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and I mean, the precision makes sense because this is a computer world.
Right.
But I guess Trinity feels alive within its, you know, precise walls or something. And I also want to point out,
these certain shots.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No. I think a lot of shots in this movie are going to make us both go, oh.
Yeah, exactly. to me, that shot where the agent just lands on the thing and he's got his gun out, I mean, that's just, it's just baked into my memory. And then coming up here when Carrie Ann Moss like gets up right away right here and she pulls the gun out, that feels very Hong Kong.
Yes, yes. And then I guess we should call out the rooftops there are reused from Dark City.
Is that right? Really?
Yeah, apparently the Wachowskis really wanted to film it outside. And, I mean, that was the thing I was curious about, too, what the budget was on this. Because in my head, I'm like, oh, this must be like $100 million or something. And it turns out it was only $60, because that's all Warners would give them. And so they went and shot in Australia so they could maintain that budget, because otherwise in the U.S. it would have been about $100.
I mean, the Dark City connection is very appropriate, given that the two films are very, you know, synonymous with each other.
Yeah, about the same time. I mean,
and kind of about the same thing. I mean, it's like, you know, I always say like film school assignments, they're both kind of telling the same story in a different way.
I'll fully admit, I watched Dark City once and enjoyed it, and I don't remember it a lot.
I mean, it's that same idea, right? You have this this overarching intelligence that's created a fictional reality that people are moving in and out through, and then you have one person who masters that reality and becomes the one, if you will.
Oh, I should revisit it.
Yeah, I mean, the two are very, very similar, and they both came out within months of each other, so it's just a happy coincidence.
I didn't realize they were so close even.
Yeah, I believe Dark City was like late 98.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
And what, folks, for those of you who don't know, Dark City, directed by Alex Proyas, who did The Crow, that was actually Roger Ebert's favorite movie of 1998. So
yeah, he does a commentary, I think.
He did a whole commentary track for it. If you haven't seen it, highly recommend it.
That's, I mean, that's kind of amazing. So what would compel him to
Yeah, exactly. So. And it's a great commentary track, by the way. But enough of that. On the
Wake up, Neo. You know, and I just want to throw out, too, like, what an awesome teaser of a beginning that is. I mean, we have these villains, and they look sort of like Secret Service agents, but then when they speak, they, like, start and finish each other's sentences. So something's off about them. I mean, it's just such a... And then we see she's got this crazy ability, you know, this almost, you know, superhero kind of thing, but it's just only teased, you know? It's like...
Yeah, it's... Want some we don't more? Know what's going
Let's
on.
Go.
I mean, the movie does a brilliant job of placing we, the audience, into the shoes of Neo. Mm-hmm. And so we come into the Matrix the same way he does.
Right.
And that really allows us to have that continuing, that escalating sense of what the hell is going on here. Up to the point where Neo first meets Morpheus.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I think that's, it's kind of brilliant. Right. And again, the brilliance of it is obscured by the fact that now the ins and outs of the Matrix have sort of become cultural shorthand. Like, everybody knows it now.
Right. Blue pill, red pill.
Yeah. You know, but it's like at that time, opening night, you know, end of March, 1999, we had no idea what we were watching. And I think that's partly what made the experience so well. This book, by the way, worth mentioning is Simulacra and Simulation by Jean Baudrillard. You know, it hinges on this idea that we live in sort of a manufactured reality, and you know, I'm boiling it down a lot, but kind of this idea that it's very Matrix-esque, his philosophical underpinnings. And so that book, and I think the chapter that we saw there is called On Nihilism. That's actually at the end of the book. That's not in the middle, but so they deliberately put that there as they wanted us to see that on nihilism, you know?
I mean, and that's another thing, too. I mean, this movie, like, wears its, you know, sort of religious allegory and philosophy, like, on its sleeve. Even this scene here is kind of funny. I remember watching this the first time when he's giving him the, like, bootleg software or whatever he's giving him. He's like, hey, man, thanks. You're my own personal Jesus Christ. I was like, huh? And then when you think about it later, you're like, oh, right. He's like,
yeah.
Maybe one of the more clunkier elders right. there, but like, got it?
Yeah, everybody got that? You know, it's funny,
yeah,
though.
Yeah, Dark Helmet.
Baudrillard, the book was required reading on the set, so clearly that was something that really informed the filmmakers. But Baudrillard himself, when asked about The Matrix, he was like, they totally misunderstood what I was trying to say. It has nothing to do with me.
Like, oh.
I know.
Now, and there's like so many little details throughout too. I just wanted to point out real quick with Trinity at the beginning, she's behind a door with a 3 on it. And Neo, the one's behind a door with a 1 on it. I mean, like, this whole thing is just really like people who are clearly passionate about this thing they were making.
They've put a lot of thought into it. And obviously the idea of Trinity and Neo becoming a couple, the 3 becomes 1, you know.
Right.
Again, it hits you over the head, but I mean, you appreciate the fact that they did weave a lot of Gnosticism into this. I mean, there's a call out to no specific brand of religion, but more a broader sense of sort of shared cultural notions of
yes.
Religious importance. You know what I mean?
Totally. Yeah. Which is like kind of cool. And I think felt almost like innovative at the time. It was like deeper and you could think about it and people could write. I mean, can you imagine think pieces back in the day for this movie?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. And it like made you feel smarter.
Yeah, you know, it's true.
For picking up on some of this stuff.
Now, worth mentioning here, Brian, that the Wachowskis actually changed the color timing of this film after the sequels came out.
That's literally what I was going to bring up.
Is that right? Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. So there's a hint of green, which they added for all the Matrix scenes, because when they did the sequels, that was a creative decision that they made. So they retroactively changed the original film to have a hint of green in all the Matrix scenes.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel I could be making this up. I feel like it had a twinge of that going on,
it did.
But now they like shot it into overdrive.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, whatever was going on in their head, they finessed it with the sequels to the degree that they wanted it, and then they wanted to retroactively fix the first one.
Yeah. I love that, too. That's such a great little transition there where you can hear the alarm clock with the beat of the song in the club. And this, too, with the window washer here. I mean, it's just they throw in this funny quirk.
Hmm.
You know, like, there is humor in this movie.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, some movies just take themselves too seriously. Like, you could see a movie like this just being deadly serious.
Yes.
But this movie's, like, playful.
Yeah, and I mean, I think, you know, there is this heightened, almost cartoonishness to, for example, this scene. And, you know, even the scene earlier, the way the police officers act around the agents and stuff, and it feels very movie-ish.
Yeah.
Like, they act like characters in a movie. This boss acts like a character in a movie.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you say, well, they are characters in this simulation, so it makes sense why they act that way. And, you know, Neo is the one person who's acting normal.
Right.
And it makes sense why he stands out.
That's funny. I never thought of that.
You know? Let's talk about Keanu Reeves, by the way.
Yeah.
We're doing like Keanu Fest 2019.
I know. Wait, real quick. I just want to point out, as long as this is like the split second, I think it's on screen.
This is the moment, yeah.
But this phone that he
right?
gets here, this is the Nokia, the Nokia 8110, a.k.a. the banana phone, which I think as soon as we saw this on screen, we're like, I want one.
Yeah, right? It how many people were doing that, you know? With...
I swear, I probably, with my flip phone, I was probably doing that with this in mind, like thinking I was flipping it open. But reading up on it, it said it was the first commercial phone to have SMS functionality.
Really?
Yeah. So, probably shot in 98.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Pretty cool. Anyway, okay, Keanu.
Would this movie work as well with anyone but Keanu Reeves? That's the eternal question.
It's easy to guess now.
Yeah.
And because I'm going to say no.
Yeah.
But because, like, as we were saying, you know, where there is this sort of inherent silliness to all this, like, he helps with that.
Hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, we do take him seriously when we need to, but he's also kind of funny in this scene, actually.
Right.
You know, like, cowering, doing his Keanu thing. So, like, Will Smith, it would maybe feel a little more serious. Even when he jokes, he takes everything around him deadly serious, you know?
Yeah, it's like I can't even wrap my brain around a version of this movie starring Will Smith.
I can, but it feels more like a popcorn movie.
Yeah.
Than this one does. Whereas this one feels like itself, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, and it's interesting because by this time, Keanu Reeves was already a big star.
You know? Yeah, yeah. He already done action.
He had already, right. He did Point Break. He'd done Speed. The movie, not the substance. Maybe the substance, I don't know. But
yeah,
but he it wasn't like this made him. It wasn't like this movie made him, but I would say this movie
right.
put him into a whole other tier.
Sure, yes.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't remember, I mean, there was like a phase where Keanu Reeves was a bit of a joke.
Yes.
I think, you know, if you said, and maybe it came from this movie or partially, you know, where, you know, whoa.
Yeah.
You know, if
I know, Kung Fu.
Yeah, and now if you bring up Keanu, everyone's like, I love that guy. You know,
yeah,
it's
well,
like
now,
he's more known for all the cool stuff he does.
Well, I mean, nowadays, Keanu Reeves, we think of him as, he's like the man who fell to Earth, and he's just wandering the planet, bringing joy and comfort to all he meets, right?
Buying motorcycles for his stunt teams,
yeah.
giving up his seat on subways to people,
right.
Yeah. Yeah, or like sad Keanu. Like, you can imagine that meme happening at a time where you're like, sad Keanu, like, what's wrong with that guy? And
right.
now you're like, sad Keanu, well, I would have sat with him, you know? Like, I feel like no one ever, I don't think, disliked him, but I think people came around on his persona and, like, love him now.
Yeah, no, I think that's fair. And, I, you know, that goes to something I talk about this in my classes, right, where we have, like, sort of a cultural skyscraper where we define, like, low culture versus high culture, you know, so low culture being, like, Jersey Shore or something, and high culture
right.
being, like, opera or whatever, you know? And what I was saying was that the key determinant of whether we consider something high culture really is longevity. The longer something sticks around, the more it feels entrenched in society and worthy of sort of being there. You know what I mean?
So, like, if we were still talking about Freddy Got Fingered,
yeah, I mean, that's,
we
yeah.
would say, well, hey, it's I don't understand the sausage scene, but yeah. here it remains.
Yeah,
so you know? Let's take a look.
I mean, you know, the James Bond films when they started, they were like kind of viewed as these like culturally destructive exploitation type movies, and now it's like this institution, you know?
Right. They're classics.
Or yeah. South Park actually is even a better example than that, you know?
Okay, sure.
You know, now it like wins Peabody Awards or whatever, you know?
Right.
So Keanu Reeves has been sort of part of the cultural ether now that he is a beloved institution.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And he has not aged, by the way, from this film to now.
No, I mean, yeah, he definitely looks young here, but like he doesn't look much different now.
No.
And 20 years later, yeah. This is another one of those movies, too, I was thinking, like Inception, where you are watching something incredible and it's a delight to the eyes, but it also requires so much explanation to the audience.
Yes.
So you have to find these creative ways to pass along that information. And I was thinking, just watching this right here with Hugo Weaving, I can hear his voice with the sound off on my television right now. And so him, you know, saying all this crazy stuff through this really entrancing performance, I mean, that's the trick,
yeah.
right? And then, of course, Morpheus later, too, when you have these dazzling visuals to accompany it, much like Inception.
Yeah.
But whatever Hugo Weaving, I don't know if this was him or if this was coming from the Wachowskis, but this is just such a memorable, fun villain. I'm just looking at Agent Smith up close now, really kind of for the first time here, noticing his sunglasses, and it's interesting. I mean, each character has their sort of distinctive sunglasses look.
So yeah, Hugo Weaving. This is the first time I ever saw him.
Oh, same here. Yeah. And forever he will be to me. I mean, I've seen him in many other things. He's great.
He's great in everything.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's, you know, and I didn't know at the time that he was Australian. So really, you appreciate this really stylized American accent that he's doing.
Mm-hmm.
And the way he just he hits these weird pressure points on the words that he's using, you know.
Yeah, I wonder how you would even explain that to him. Like, what is he doing? You know, like
that's
it's to
question.
Me, I would think of an agent in the way that he's sort of speaking. So I wonder what the direction was. It's so funny and distinct. I'm going to give you the finger.
How many times did you see this in the theater? I'm curious.
That is a good question. I'm sure more than once. I don't recall. But this was the movie that made me go buy a DVD player.
Well, you're not alone there.
I think this, yeah, I mean, DVD should, like, be giving the Wachowskis, like, residual pay, because that's probably the case for most people.
For a while, this was the best-selling DVD of all time.
Yeah.
And you know, DVD had only been introduced into the marketplace maybe 3 years earlier, so...
Yeah.
There weren't a lot of options before this. It wasn't like, oh, Batman and Robin, But this was like the demo disc that, like, when a friend came over and was like, "Hey, what's this DVD everyone's talking about?"
Yeah.
Like, check this out.
I don't know.
This bit
my
here,
VHS
Brian,
is what?
No, I just want to point out this bit here is really where the movie, you know, with Keanu and his mouth and everything, is where the movie sort of jumps the rails into
Crazy Town.
Crazy Town, science fiction. You know?
Yes.
And
get this little bug that is crawling into his
mouth. Oh, my goodness.
Let alone his mouth being shut.
I mean, yeah, it's you know, because up to this point, we've sort of, it's been like heightened reality, but still reality as far as we know.
Yeah.
And so what we see, the further along we get, the further up to the point where Neo meets Morpheus, it's like being, for us in the audience, it's like being in a dream where you're just unsettled and you don't understand what's going on.
Yes. Yeah. 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 It's a nice little cut out of there too, because how it feels like a waking from a dream.
Yeah.
By the way, I just want to real life here. Apologize. Apparently my neighbor is hanging every picture they've ever bought. So I apologize if you're hearing a bunch of hammering or.
That's really funny.
Anyway, just let it be, into the rhythm of the world around you. Let it blend in. Just real quick. Yeah, going back to DVD. I remember buying the thing and then buying this. And then what was so cool is it's the first time I ever saw a menu for a movie. So I remember it was like the Matrix music and like that, like a sizzle reel of all the action in the film and being like, whoa. Like everything is changed.
I remember that. I remember that opening shot of Trinity in the bullet time shot is like one of the menu shots in the Matrix.
Yeah, yeah.
That and like the bullet dodging later.
Yes, I mean that was the image. I mean I still do that actually when people throw things at me. I lean back in slow motion. Like that's.
And hear it's funny hear that, folks. If you ever meet Brian and you throw a thing at him,
yeah. If you throw an eraser at me or something, yeah.
He will do the Matrix dodge.
Yeah.
Now, something that is worth mentioning here is the characters in the film. Are very androgynous in their appearance.
Right.
Specifically, Neo and Trinity. I've said this before that if you look at them, if you were to look at them from a distance, you'd almost be like, "Who's who?"
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. I never thought about that, but with the two of them.
I mean, that it makes a lot of sense when we look at the journey that the Wachowskis have been on in their lives.
Right, right.
Exploring notions of gender fluidity. I mean, the whole idea of Neo being stuck in this programmed reality and having to accept who he is. I mean, even at the time, the Wachowskis were trying to work through their gender issues.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that adds this very this interesting element. It's certainly another reading for this film.
Yeah, and apparently, speaking of that character Switch,
yes,
the name Switch was because in one reality it was going to be played by a male, and then they're going to have this female actress playing it in the other reality. So Switch.
How interesting.
Yeah, but I think the Warner Brothers thought that would confuse audiences.
Sure, sure. When you think about it, I mean, that actually, like nowadays, that would not be confusing at all.
No, you just need like a little line. I think, at the time they thought it would just be this whole scene. You'd have to explain what was going on. And
yeah, I mean, nowadays, the idea of having a video game avatar, I mean, hell, Ready Player One is like built around that.
Right, right. Yeah, we've caught up to video game logic.
That's right.
Yeah.
In that sense, Brian, this movie is sort of quaint in the way it really does heavily explain stuff that I have a feeling now would not need explanation.
Yeah, just like how computers work or right. Like the leaps of just why something happens. Like, yeah, you might have questioned it more in the past and now you're like, well, that's because that's what this movie's doing. we're there now.
Yeah, exactly.
Whatever you want to present to us, we'll accept. that was gross when that thing comes out. It's like covered in like strawberry jelly.
Now, Morpheus, what a great, great intro for his character.
Yeah.
They had offered the part to Val Kilmer originally.
Yeah. Which I can sort of get. I sort of get what they're going for, although that would never be my choice.
Yes.
He's got this thing with sunglasses.
Yeah. you know what's interesting is had they made it Will Smith and Val Kilmer, Will Smith as Neo, Val Kilmer as Morpheus, I the problem I would have had there would have been the idea of a white guy teaching a black guy like who he really is. I think it means more that Morpheus is African-American.
Interesting.
You know what I mean? Like, maybe really just purely on an unconscious level, and maybe this is just with 20 years of hindsight, but I mean,
sure.
You know what I mean? Like, the idea that the wisdom comes from this person who, in a traditional cultural diaspora, is ostracized or treated differently.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Yeah. That's a good read. I've never thought about it. What I love about him is he feels, more like wizened.
Yes.
You know, like Val Kilmer is the saint, you know? Let's be honest.
He's a saint. No, I'm just
kidding. I mean, in this era. I love Val Kilmer. I'm saying in this era. Yeah. Or, you know what I mean? Or he's, you know, Top Gun. I can't think of his name.
Iceman.
But, yeah, Iceman. But like Morpheus, like if this guy pulls me aside and tells me everything I know is wrong, I'm like, well, what about it? You know, like, tell me more. Like, I don't know. You just...
That's true.
He just exudes a wisdom, which is funny because, you know, he's obviously a bit older than Keanu here, but he also keeps up with the action that's required of him later.
Yes. You know, he's substantially thinner here, Lawrence Fishburne, than in the other films.
Oh, I didn't even think about that.
Yeah, I mean, because he does a good job in this, but I mean, you know, there's certain fight scenes in Matrix Reloaded, for example, where it's like, you know, it looks slightly off because it's clear that Lawrence Fishburne has packed on a little bit.
Interesting. Yeah, I know. In this one later, when he is fighting in that bathroom, like, it's almost like they cater to each actor's strengths.
Yes.
You know, like sort of like Trinity's agility, and for Morpheus, it's like his power.
Yes. He fights. Just sort of raw physicality.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And you know what's interesting, too, is that both Lawrence Fishburne and Keanu Reeves, like I said, I mean, Keanu Reeves was a known quantity. So was Lawrence Fishburne. I mean, these guys were not unknowns. Yeah. And yet, they just disappeared into these characters.
Right. Yeah.
And I would say for both of them, these are really career-defining characters for them.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, this is like iconic now.
So, Brian, here's the question: knowing what Neo knows right at this moment, which pill do you take?
Honestly, movie sake, I mean, it's been teased so much, and obviously, this has been plaguing him for so long. You can understand why he'd want to wake up, and he has not seen where he is going. You know,
sure.
That like awful reality.
Yeah.
So I guess there's no going back. I wonder if I was feeling the same things he was, if I would have to know.
Like at that moment, what do you do? Mm-hmm. Right? I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. What about you?
I mean, I truly don't know. I'd like to believe I'd have the courage to keep going down that rabbit hole. You know, I mean, the truth is, when we talk about human psychology, we have the unerring ability to accept a pleasing fiction over an unpleasant truth. That's just how human beings are. We see that borne out in big ways and small ways. So we see that literalized sort of in this film. You know, we see it later with Cypher, where he's like, just plug me back in. I don't want to remember any of it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
He's like, I don't care if I'm, you know, this thing that my brain tells me is chicken isn't actually, I want to believe it's chicken.
Right.
I mean, I think that says something very basic about human nature, which is that's what most people prefer.
Yeah. I mean, if I had the opportunity on the Nebuchadnezzar to go back, I would be tempting for sure.
Yeah. I mean, to be honest, you know, you talk about think pieces and everything. I mean, that's the reason this film launched so many conversations, because it really did get into something fundamental. I mean, you know, you hear me talk all the time about the example of a good movie is where you're like, what would you do? What would you do?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, The Matrix covers that in spades, you know, that's, I mean, you know, especially what we're about to see in just a few seconds here when Neo wakes up in, you know, the real world.
Uh-huh.
And it's just this horror show, right?
Yeah. And also adding to the conversations it asks, I mean, there's a lot of wish fulfillment in here that I still think about, like the concept of being able to download how to fly a helicopter or know kung fu all of a sudden. I mean, I think about that all the time. I think I still joke about that to this day, where if there's something I don't know, or I just wish I could download it in my head, like The Matrix, you know, and then I just know how to speak Spanish all of a sudden, or I know how to, you know.
That's really funny.
Fly an airplane.
And, you know, what I love is that even up to this point, we don't know what's going on. Like, the concept of what The Matrix actually is not in our frame of reference right now.
Yeah, we, like you said earlier, I mean, we are completely with Neo. And what's funny about that, too, is, or not funny, but brilliant, is that we don't mind rewatching this discovery over and over again.
Yes.
As a film. Like, this is still entertaining to watch.
I mean, what a moment this is right here, because it's a total paradigm shift if you're watching for the first time. You're like, what the hell? What just happened?
Yes.
Yeah. You know?
Well, yeah, for people who aren't following along, this is Keanu in a tub of goo.
Keanu's virgin birth.
Yeah. Yeah, and he, no eyebrows and shaved head and ugh.
It's
like seeing all that stuff plugged into his body.
Yeah, the plugs, like the tubes and the plugs, always gross me out.
Yeah, yeah.
Now,
which is kind of a cool detail then. So when you know they're in the real world and they have these like outlets all over their bodies.
Yes.
Yeah. What were you going to say?
No, I mean, it's, you know, what we see right now is horrifying, right? It's all these tanks full of people who are plugged in and whatnot, and it really sets up sort of the what the world is. And even still, we don't really know what's going on until later when Morpheus explains it. But, you know, I think talking about what the Wachowskis lay out in the sequels, a lot of what this film is doing is presenting a world, a binary world of good and evil, that they then proceed to tear down in the sequels and tear down our presuppositions. And I don't want to spend too much time talking about the sequels in this track, but I mean, I think you can't help but talk about them because that's part of that's part of the story, but it's also part of the collective experience people had with The Matrix. Which is that the first film tells one story and sets up certain expectations, and then the sequels are about tearing down those expectations. And I think that's why the sequels are on the light end, not as loved, on the other end, reviled.
Right, sure.
You know, and I'm somebody, I mean, I went on my own journey with the sequels where I was apathetic initially, and then now I adore the sequels. And I can't.
Because I sort of bought into that, yeah, they're not as great kind of thing, and you were the one who was like, hey, give them another shot. and I did, and I like them now too. I still find the third one to be the weakest entry.
Yeah, I agree with that.
For just certain reasons, but I think the second one's great.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I mean the action sequences in the second one are next level.
Yeah, I mean, some of my favorite moments in the whole series are in the second one. Yeah.
Yeah, I totally agree. But I mean, that's the thing, right? I mean, you know, we watch this film and we're dropped in to Neo as our point of view character, and here's Morpheus explaining the world to us in very binary terms, and the series in a large sense, is saying even Morpheus is wrong. He's looking at it the wrong way, you know?
I mean,
not...
can we use you as a cheat sheet here? Like, I don't actually really remember how this series ends. It's the architect talking to the Oracle, and what was it? Like, he wasn't the one, right?
Well, no, he was the one, but the idea, like, what does the one represent, right? Like, the whole thing, what Neo realizes is peace. Like, that's what they want. They want peace. Well, peace doesn't mean destroying the other side. Peace means coming to an accord with the other side. And if you come to an accord with the other side, you can't come to an accord if you're like, oh, the other side is evil. Right, so it's not like, oh, machines evil, humans good. It's there's good machines, there's good humans. Right?
Oh man, I need to revisit those.
Yeah, because think about it. The Oracle is a program.
Right.
So the Oracle is a part of the machine world, and yet what is she doing? She's helping the humans.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And the Architect is not the evil overlord.
Mm-hmm.
He's another program too. I mean, the Oracle and the Architect are the mother and father of the Matrix. The way they speak to each other at the end, they're like a married couple.
Right.
You know? So, and fundamentally what we arrive at the end is this, it's a disassembling of this idea that victory only happens when we blow up the Death Star.
Hmm.
Right? And I think people were expecting the Death Star to blow up.
Yeah.
And not to say that that is not emotionally fulfilling. You know, it's not a critique of Star Wars, but that's not the only way to have an emotionally fulfilling, right. You know? But people just, you can vouch for this. I mean, the disappointment people had with those sequels was largely, well, that's not what I was expecting.
Yeah.
Right? And so, you know, when we talk about the way people are all irked about The Last Jedi, like, to me, I flash back to what happened with the Matrix sequels.
Hmm.
You know?
Yeah, that's another thing, too, is, I mean, when we have these big movies coming up, when we think of the movies we're excited for this year, we think of Star Wars, Marvel,
yep.
You know, all this stuff. But this, like we were saying earlier, this is a movie that came out of nowhere.
Yes.
And became a cultural phenomenon. And yes. Then when the sequels came out, we were as excited for this as Star Wars. So, I remember they were doing screenings literally from midnight through 1, 2, 3 a.m., 4 a.m. Like, I know people who went at like 4 a.m. to
wow.
see it because that was the time they got.
Amazing.
And it was sort of a weird thing for people to walk out of it and not feel how they expected.
Yes.
Right? Like the excitement for this series sort of diminished a little bit. And then also, I mean, we've talked about this before where we wonder if the legacy of the first one has been diminished a little bit just because of people's feelings for the series as a whole.
Yeah, I mean, certainly there was a lot of people, and there are a lot of people still who are like, you know, as far as I'm concerned, The Matrix is only one movie. There's no sequels. And and that's fine. I mean, if that's a way you can continue to appreciate the film, I hear a lot of that.
You know, I
don't co-sign that because to me, I can't view, you know, it's a little bit like, well, once you know the rest of the world out there, you can't just, you know, you can't live in the fictional reality of the first film being the only film.
Right.
Now this is all, I mean, this sequence here, great. we're in the construct. First of all, it's so well shot,
uh-huh.
In the way that like we are the cameras, you know, the camera is our point of view.
Mm-hmm.
The way it just so subtly moves around, the way stuff gets added to the scene. But this is just telling the audience. It's just laying out exactly everything we need to know about the Matrix, how things work in the Matrix,
mm-hmm.
So that everything from here to the end makes sense.
Yeah.
And this is an important thing in screenwriting. You have to lay out the rules of your world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and sometimes that means just saying exactly, you can do this, you can't do this, you just...
Right.
You know, that's what you have to do. Because this movie exists in a completely bonkers world, yet we're never like, oh, come on.
Yeah.
And it's because the movie took the time to explain the rules.
And you know what's interesting, too? Not to become this guy, but I was reading... I don't have it somewhere on my sheet here, but like... This movie is really only about 20% visual effects, which is shocking to me. And I remember the same thing when I read like Back to the Future literally only has like 10 visual effects shots in it or something. And you're like, what? Because wow. In my head, you know, they're so much bigger. But it's like, well, the movie makes you think it's big. Or it's big in its own way, you know what I mean? And it's like you sort of fill in the gap. So even like this moment here where we're in some sort of fantastic reality, it's really just a stage. It's a white stage with two chairs.
That's
but it
so
feels
funny.
Fantastic because it's a little otherworldly and unnerving.
Yeah.
So it's like they find these tactile ways to convey some of this stuff. Like, I mean, they didn't even really have the technology to do what they would have done now. So, I mean, when you actually see the actors in a real environment that feels... off.
Yeah.
You know, it goes a lot longer of a way than putting them in some sort of CG environment that just is off.
That, yeah. Wow, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, so it's almost like the limitations of the time were to its benefit.
Huh. Now Morpheus here, he mentioned, you know, when you come here, he says, "Welcome to the desert of the real." Mm. And that's a phrase, I was referring to Baudrillard earlier. That's a specific phrase from Baudrillard. So I mean that sort of existential philosophy that he engaged in is just woven in throughout this. Now the important thing to remember about this scene, right? You point to this scene, and you know it's Morpheus explaining what happened, but it's still exposition filtered through Morpheus. Mm-hmm, so mm-hmm. It's his perspective, his point of view. All this is horrifying, right? This bit here with the baby and the thing and everything. Mm. But it's still Morpheus' point of view. And I think that's really important because what the film is trying to say is that we can't be indentured solely to specific points of view. We have to be able to look at the big picture. And
I've never thought about that. That's really good. Yeah.
Right? I mean, that's really important. And you know, there was a series of animated shorts released in conjunction with the sequels called The Animatrix.
Yeah.
Which I believe you've seen, right?
I have. I'll be honest, I don't remember anything about them.
Yeah, well, I mean...
I probably watched them at the time.
It's like 15, 16 years old, right? There's a two-part animated short called The Second Renaissance, which explains in sort of excruciating detail... what led to the machine, you know, the nuclear war.
Mm.
And it's fascinating in how it really depicts the machines as a downtrodden underclass, that sort of a Planet of the Apes situation.
I'm seeing it now. I remember images from it.
Yeah. And all of that is now new information. That's new data that you have to bring in as you analyze this. And you say, well, it's not as simple as sort of the binary worldview that Morpheus is describing. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
That's great.
And that's why, yeah, Switch calls him Copper Top earlier, the whole battery
thing. Yeah, Copper Top. That's right.
Yeah.
It's. I mean,
see, now this is where you're like, well, I shouldn't have taken that pill.
Right, exactly. Joey Pants, by the way, he's such a weasel in this movie.
Yeah, he's so great. I feel like I don't see him as much anymore. He used to pop up in almost everything.
He was like the guy for a while. He was ubiquitous, yeah.
Yeah, Bad Boys and Fugitive and this.
Well, one assumes he'll be in the third Bad Boys, right? I think they're filming that right now.
Oh, yeah.
That makes this commentary track a little time capsule because.
Yeah. That's like a nicely framed shot, by the way, with Neo in the foreground laying down. Like, I can't go back, huh?
Yeah.
And Morpheus in the shadow. No, sorry.
Nope. Sucks to be you.
Yeah. You know, I wanted to also bring up the movie Johnny Mnemonic.
Yeah.
Because
that's right.
That was a movie that. Yeah, that came out in 95. This came out in 99, which also starred Keanu Reeves and was sort of like a cyber... I don't know if cyberpunk would be the
correct term. William Gibson.
Sort of a virtual reality thriller.
Yeah, that's right.
And Warners was skeptical about this movie because of that movie's failure. And I don't know. I just kind of want to throw that out there. Like, the 90s were a funny time with computers, right? Like, we were on the cusp of something, but we didn't quite know what. Like, we had the movie The Net with Sandra Bullock.
Yes, that's right.
No, good.
No, I mean, there was that. There was Virtuosity with Denzel Washington.
Right. And then, you know, something that I had forgotten about was Johnny Mnemonic was virtual reality, right? If I remember correctly.
To some extent, yeah. It's about, yeah, I mean, it's that cyberpunk William Gibson aesthetic.
Yeah, and then you had Lawnmower Man.
Even
the Jurassic sequel. Park, they're like, using virtual reality. Yeah. You know, when they're talking about how they harvesting the eggs and whatever. And then I thought of recently the movie Disclosure, you know, the Michael Crichton story, the sexual harassment thing, Michael Douglas, Demi Moore. And I was watching like the last 40 minutes of it on TV. And there's like a whole virtual reality element to that movie. Do you remember that?
I mean, I can't remember that movie. So
it's like the company is, you know, using virtual reality to like store files. And there's like this whole really crazy sequence where he like, is trying to find a file. Like normally you'd be like you're in the hallway of a building and going to a file cabinet with a flashlight, but he's in this virtual reality world.
How funny.
To go get the file, and she's in there too, and he's trying to like hide. And I was like, man, it's just so funny. And then that never really caught on. And
right.
Now I'd say like virtual reality has finally become kind of a thing. We're like, oh yeah, I can go to a mall and pretend I'm in a canoe, you know?
Right.
Like,
that's
took about
right.
20 years.
Yeah, it's very quaint.
Yeah.
It's a bit
like...
I know
Dozer here. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, Dozer, go ahead. I was going to say that.
Wait, no, what's his name? That's his brother, right? So this is...
That's Tank.
Operator.
Tank is the operator, and Dozer is the brother. Tank is played by Marcus Chong, son of...
Yeah, and he gets
Tommy
replaced.
Chong. Yeah, because he wanted more money.
Yeah.
And he, like, made a big
stink. He's really good in this. I mean, just this scene alone, like, where he gets his kind of minute to shine, he's so good. And then and all the stuff he's doing at the hub... or whatever you want to call it, you know, just sort of reacting to what's going on that he's not a part of. Like, he's really good in this movie.
Yeah, it's a shame. I mean, like I said, I think he was looking for a significant pay bump.
Yeah.
For the sequels, and they were like, all right, well, bring in Harold Perrineau instead. And so that's why Link is in the second and third ones.
Yeah.
That's what happens.
This whole, another little twist on the guy in the chair, I guess, right?
Yeah, is this like the first man in the chair, you know?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I'm not sure. Because, I mean, you wouldn't have had that sort of trope in the 80s because you couldn't do all that crap from computers.
That's what I'm saying.
Right?
I mean, I think this may just be the first man in the chair.
Yeah, at least the first completely memorable, defined version of it.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it is now. Yeah, I mean, it's now a thing where you can say, oh, the man in the chair, and we know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. By the way, so right there when he's downloading all this crap into his head, he's just like, Tank just says, hey, Mikey, I think he likes it.
Yep.
Which is from an old Life cereal commercial, which is funny. I was realizing the other day, I quote things that came from a time before me because the things I watch quote them. But it's like, if someone were to ask me about what I'm quoting, I'm like, I don't even really know what that is.
And can I tell you something, Brian? That is the definition. Yeah. Of simulacra and simulation. That's exactly what Baudrillard was talking about, where we live in an age where we have references where we don't even know what the reference is referring to, but we cling to the reference. So,
well, and that is why I brought it up.
There you go. Right. And it's funny because the quote is wrong. It's it's, hey, Mikey likes it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So way to screw it up, Tank. That's my point.
Like Luke, I'm your father.
Yeah, exactly. Right. It's just one of those things. Like now we know, hey, Mikey, I think he likes it, which has become, that's become the quote.
Yeah. Like, talk about, okay, we'll get into like all the training they did. Right now we're watching him in the simulation fighting Morpheus.
Yeah.
And obviously they put in a crap load of time and training into this. But I mean, you can't undersell how well this is photographed and edited to just really sell what they're doing and not make this look ridiculous.
Yes.
Like, this could have looked stupid, these two actors actually doing this stuff, but instead mm-hmm. you're like, holy crap. Like, they are impressive.
And the fight, the training and choreography is by Yuen Wu Ping,
mm-hmm.
who's a famous Hong Kong director.
Yeah, and apparently they asked him to be a part of this and he didn't want to do it. Right, so he refused it, and so that they wouldn't want him. He asked for an absorbent amount of money, and they're like, "Okay." And he's like, "Oh, okay. Well, if that's the case, then I want complete control of the fight." So they're like, "Great."
Yeah.
And then he finally was like, "Well, then all the actors have to put in like 6 months of training and all these requirements," and they're like, "Sounds good."
I mean, it is interesting because the choreography of the fight right here is what you would see in like a Hong Kong martial arts movie,
right.
And I think it's just funny how, you know, in order to make that work in an American film, they had to add the mechanism of the Matrix, which allows for this sort of zero gravity. I mean, you know what I mean? Like Crouching Tiger, we watch that, we're just like, oh, well, that's just how that movie is. Like, that's just the reality of that
right,
movie.
Right, 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 right.
But I don't think you could get it. Yeah.
Yeah, they can fly.
Right, you know. Yeah, Lawrence Fishburne's really good in this movie.
How did I beat you? Too fast. But yeah, I mean, I just, not enough can be said about how well directed this movie is.
Yeah.
I mean, just the, and then having these really, these sort of, I don't know if you call them insert shots, but when Morpheus is sweeping his leg and having the camera low on the ground so the foot goes whoop into the frame and then, you know, it's just, I don't know. Like, just, it really is something to be said where, you know, God bless Christopher Nolan, but like, his action is awful, you know, like, or his fight choreography is awful. You know, it's just literally, the choreography could be great, but the way it's captured is like three cameras pointed at it and then just some random cutting. So you lose what's happening and it's just sort of like a blur of just blah, 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 blah till it's over.
Well, and
like, this is,
yeah, I mean,
all this, intentional.
It, right. Exactly. I mean, it's the movement is easy to follow along with. There's a progression. There's an escalation.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's, and of course, it's just one of the most famous movie tropes. Yeah. The come at me. Come at me, bro.
Yeah. And then I asked for 15 extra minutes before we started this morning, and that was the gift you sent me.
That's right. You know,
go ahead.
No, please, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, with the little digital effect applied to Neo's hand to show how fast he's going, it's making me realize how little CGI has been applied to their action in this movie.
Yeah, and I think
to them
that's,
personally.
I think that's what makes it work. I mean, it's fun to watch, and you're able to appreciate the artistry of human movement.
Yeah.
As opposed to, I think that's one of the flaws in the second one is, you know, there's the burly brawl.
Yes, 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 yes.
Where it's Neo fighting like a dozen Agent Smiths, you know, and it's a very poorly CGI rendered Keanu Reeves.
And at the time, I mean, they thought like we did it, right?
Yeah.
And they did. They cracked something that has been improved upon.
Yes. But
I mean, think of Captain Marvel just recently. I was thinking that, like, I mean, obviously a lot of that action is not, that's a CGI.
Well, she wasn't flying around in space.
Well, but I mean, I doubt she was on a green screen stage twirling around and, you know.
That's true. But I mean,
but
Brian, I remember watching the Burly Brawl in 2003 being like, that looks awful. So it wasn't even like, oh, it's aged badly.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. That's a good point. It definitely looks worse in our minds now that we have other things to compare it to. I do remember maybe squinting a little bit and forgiving it as it was happening because it was cool.
Sure.
But now you're like, yeah, this looks kind of.
I mean, it was interminable. It went on forever. That was the other thing.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe I'll stand in its corner and be like, it's kind of fun.
I mean, I'm a defender of those sequels, but the Burly Brawl was not very good.
Okay, yeah, all right. I'll say it. I'm a fan. I mean, I'm a fan, fully aware that you're correct.
Like, you know, in the third one, right? They have the final battle between Smith and Neo, and that I could watch that every day. I think it's amazing.
See, I think that scene is garbage.
Okay, well, you son of a...
I'm just kidding.
You know, what I think is worth mentioning is here how they really go out of their way to show just how completely shitty the real world is.
I know. Here, eat this snot.
Yeah, they're eating disgusting food. They're wearing, like, Urban Outfitter reject clothing. You know, it's like, what a dump.
Yeah. No, I would not be very happy here.
Yeah. You know, so I don't know. Cypher maybe is onto something. I mean, playing the biblical metaphor forward, obviously Cypher is Judas in this whole thing.
Judas. Yep. Sells out the one.
Yeah. Right. Now, you know, the chosen one trope has really been you know, sort of beaten into submission by now. Like, it's been done so much that now we're at the point where we are critiquing that trope and challenging it. But, I mean, it was a relatively new thing at the time of this movie. Not yeah, new, but not new. It was not overdone at the time of this movie.
I was going to say, yes, or like for mainstream sort of media, yeah. I mean, it hadn't been overdone, exactly. And then years later, we would get a movie literally called The One, yes, with Jet Li in
with
it.
With Jet Li, and that movie yep. is amazing garbage.
I haven't seen it.
Oh, it's like, that is so bad it's good, you know?
Yeah. Oh, we should talk about this thing here with the woman in the red dress. That's a lot right. of the... Because this is supposed to be a simulation, so a lot of the actors in the background are twins. Because they want it to feel repetitive.
That's interesting. I didn't know that. Wow.
Yeah. And this still looks cool, by the way, where they freeze it and they're walking around.
That's great.
It looks really good. Yeah.
I've seen somebody... have you seen the Confused Travolta meme?
Yeah.
So somebody did that, like they did this scene and it freezes and you just have Confused Travolta in the corner like, what's going on?
That was one of my the better favorite memes of mine in the past couple of years.
So funny. Just the, you know, I mean, it's amazing how internet society sort of does that, where we just create these things and the yeah. thing, I mean, the Matrix foreshadowed it.
Wait, how so?
I mean, it's exactly this idea where, like we create meaning through these things that didn't exist, and it's just we're not talking about the referent, we're talking about the reference as the thing.
Yeah, and speaking of this image, very image of Morpheus here is a meme.
That's
what
right.
if I told you. Yeah, that? Yeah.
I saw one of those is my favorite, where it says, "What I if told you, you read the top line wrong."
Yeah, right. Yeah.
It's...
Look
I
at
mean,
the reflection of his glasses, by the way. You can see the agent's gun pointed at Neo in Morpheus's glasses. That's so cool.
So that would have to be some kind of a... They would have to have done something digitally to make that work, right?
Feels like it, because otherwise it'd be the camera. But it looks good.
It looks very good, yeah. And I know so many people wanted those sunglasses. We're talking about the cell phones. Those sunglasses yeah. that you just sort of... plop on your nose.
Yeah. I wonder how those would work.
Yeah, I mean,
that
it would
get annoying on the bridge of your nose.
You'd have to squeeze it onto your nose, yeah.
Yeah. It'd have to get like those weird glasses like Naven Johnson in The Jerk, where they have like the little hook. Remember that? The bridge of your nose.
And there's our reference to The Jerk in The Matrix. I love it.
Yep.
We're an all-purpose
Damn,
commentary
these glasses.
Track.
Yeah.
By the way,
I'll admit this. Oh, good. Yeah.
I just want to really briefly mention Carrie Ann Moss, who.
Yeah.
Like, she is so. I think, you know, she. Like, even now, we tend to associate her with these films. And she's really good. And I remember watching this movie and being like, she is so beautiful, but like in this very unique, distinctive way.
Yeah. Like, I don't know what other... You know, a lot of times you can be like, oh, she's a Marilyn Monroe type, or she's a this type. Like, she's her own type. Yeah. She's beautiful.
And really an icon. I mean, an iconic female character.
Yeah, and that's what's so cool. She's not just, like, this prop, you know? I mean, she's a badass. Like, she's the one that's teaching Neo everything, and she believes in him, but he's got to look up to her.
Yeah.
She's the one that's leading the way.
Exactly.
And you know, you think in lesser directors, perhaps a lesser actress sort of scenario, she's just kind of coldly reading things. Like, there is like a beating heart to Trinity, and that's a credit to this movie and why I think we think she's so cool.
I think so. I mean, and I think to some extent, it almost loses a step when it introduces the love element.
Yeah.
Especially now, 20 years later, because our... concept of female characters has really marched on to being more than just the love interest, and you know, I think I mentioned this to you previously. I screened this film for a class just about a year ago. A lot of them hadn't seen it, and that was the stuff that took them out, was the love story.
It does feel like requirement.
Yes, check the
more
boxes.
Than organic. Yeah.
Like, I guess this
even though, I mean, I can understand it. I mean, if you're locked in this hellscape, you know, and then some interesting person enters, like, of course you're going to have some sort of, like, draw to them.
Plus, he's Keanu Reeves. I mean, come on.
I mean, yeah.
He's Ted Theodore Logan.
He's Ted Theodore Logan. These, like, little glyphs, by the way, I mean, this became, like, another sort of thing that was I mean, you just see this imagery of these little reigning symbols, and you're like, oh, yeah, yeah. Like, I actually remember at one point this was a screensaver you could get, and I was like, I want that screensaver.
That's right. I remember that.
And apparently they're reverse letters, numbers, and Japanese characters. And I thought I read somewhere the I don't know if it's production designer or whoever was saying that a lot of them is like Japanese food words, so it's like sushi and stuff.
Really?
Yeah. There's been a bunch of interesting articles because it's the 20th anniversary this year, which is kind of fun. Just all the people working on the movie just dropping little tidbits like that.
Yeah. Ugh.
It's like drinking this like homemade moonshine.
Yeah, right, exactly. Nebuchadnezzar moonshine. No, thank you.
Yeah. Oh, speaking of, we should mention the ship, the Nebuchadnezzar, is a biblical reference.
Yes.
Because that was a king who was having dreams. And he needed them interpreted by Daniel. So here, there, everywhere.
I mean, in terms of sort of the biblical structure that the film sets up, what is Morpheus's role? Is he John the Baptist?
Oh, Morpheus. Yeah, yeah. Well, that makes sense, right? Yeah. Paving the way.
Yeah.
Well, but he's also sort of... I mean, obviously, you can't make this like a one-to-one reference,
right?
But like I was gonna say, in this movie, he's snapping it, making the one realize he's the one, whereas like John the Baptist would be like calling out and getting everyone ready for him,
which is what he's doing. I mean, he's
his people, yeah,
right.
On
especially when we get to the sequels and we expand the world. I mean, he's the one who nobody's listening to.
Yes, at Zion. Yeah. Oh, right. Look at that steak. And you know, this is like completely, he's not like a mustache twirly villain.
Right.
Like you're like, no, I get it. I mean, what he's doing is really crappy, but yeah, no, I get it.
I mean, it goes to, when we talk about the hierarchy of needs, right? You know, short-term survival is our most pressing need, food, water, oxygen. And then after that is safety and shelter. And mm-hmm. when we talk about safety and shelter, it's not just actual physical safety and shelter. It's also emotional safety, emotional shelter, the perception of safety, right? Mm-hmm. How important that is. And this goes to what I was saying earlier, we'll take the pleasing fiction
mm-hmm.
over the unpleasant truth. I always give this example, right? Like every night before I go to bed, I'm, lock all the windows and stuff. I go to the front door. I flip the latch. I flip the deadbolt and I put the little chain. I'm like, safe. And it's like, not really. 'Cause there's a picture window right next to my door that somebody could throw a rock through. I've seen The Purge. I know how this goes,
Yeah.
But we need that. We need to convince ourselves that everything is okay, even if it means willfully disregarding things that conflict with that. And so what Cypher is doing is just an extreme expression of that.
Yeah. Yeah, that's, yeah.
I mean, not to say what he's doing is right, but that's why he's doing it.
But no, yeah. It's something that we can even, like, disagree with and think sucks, but, like, well, yeah, I understand. I understand why he's doing it.
Yeah, and I mean to the movie's credit, you sort of see the heel turn coming because it's not completely out of the blue with Cypher.
Right. By the way, so Miles is talking about Tasty Wheat.
Yes.
Have you ever had Tasty Wheat?
I have not had Tasty Wheat.
Yeah, I haven't either. I was just thinking about that last night. I was remembering this quote and like, I don't know. I love the way he says that, by the way. Remember, this performance is kind of funny, where he's like, tastes like anything, like add tuna fish.
Yeah.
You remember that?
Yeah. I think what I remember most about when this movie came out was exactly kind of what we're doing right now. It's all these conversations where people were like, they were like Keanu Reeves. Whoa. Like they were having that moment of moment of zen where it's like, am I just a figment of somebody else's imagination? You
know? Right. Which I feel like people have these conversations a lot more now, even to this day, like, well, this is all just someone's dream anyway, you know? thing.
And that's something that The Matrix added to the cultural conversation.
Yeah. With some killer action.
That's right. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, I talked about Dark City. Dark City covers a lot of the same ground, but I mean, at the time, the movie, it didn't do anything, you know? And I think part of it is because it was too sort of inside itself and it's very artsy fartsy.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think what the Wachowskis cracked is, well, you can have those philosophical conversations, but you got to have some ass kicking and, you know, some, you know, lots of bullets flying.
And this feels, I mean, it's a very hero's journey, satisfying sort of story.
Yes.
You know, by the way, I don't even know what music cue is playing right now on screen, but I can imagine what it sounds like.
Yes.
Some kind of cool techno sounding thing. And now we're seeing them all in their leather coats looking like badasses. And that's another thing, too. Like, I think to this day, we still kind of have the influence of this sort of cool beat, you know, not EDM. I don't know what you call it. Techno EDM, whatever.
Yeah.
Sort of thing, scoring action, you know? Like, I don't really recall that happening before this.
No, I think you're right. And I also think, I mean, that there was a very specific definition of what cool looks like, briefly anyway, based on The Matrix.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I don't know if you remember, people were blaming The Matrix for the Columbine shootings. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I was gonna bring that up, because that happened shortly after. If this came out March 99, and that would have been like April. I want to say.
Yeah, that was April. Yeah. And just idiotic.
Yeah.
To even make that connection. And the most arbitrary, they wore trench coats.
Yes. Oh, that's right. Because I do recall this was still in, I did see this more than once in the theater, because I remember I saw it after that happened.
Yes.
And there was something a little chilling having that imagery in your head in a whole other context and then watching them on screen.
Yeah.
Dressed in the way as described from the news and just, you know, shooting people down.
Yes.
I kind of forgot about that. Yeah.
Yeah. The Matrix became the latest thing to blame as opposed to video games or you name it, you know, because that's just what we do, you know?
And it's funny too, is this movie is rated R.
Yes.
But it doesn't really feel like it. Like, I don't think anyone curses once in this movie.
Yeah, I mean, people say shit a lot, but I don't think we hear the F word, no.
Yeah, yeah. So it's kind of, it's just all like, apparently, I mean, the violence, I guess.
I think the violence, specifically the third act shootout, is pretty much what gave it its R rating.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because, I mean, we've talked about this before. I mean, with a very few minor cuts, this would be a PG-13 movie today.
Easily, yeah.
And that's the other thing, to be honest, is that a $60 million budget lets you be an R-rated movie.
Mm-hmm.
I think it helped the Wachowskis that nobody had any real expectations for this, and so they were able to make the movie they wanted.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the fact that the sequels were R-rated was a reflection of, well, because the first one was, you know, but you can easily, I mean, the expectations that came with those sequels, I'm sure Warner Brothers was hoping it could have been PG-13, you know?
But I do remember at the time, I don't know, this could be through my own lens, but like ratings, you know, now like people seem to take their kids to any old thing. But it seemed like at the time people were a little more conscious of that sort of thing. But I remember this was like a movie where like everybody took everybody. Like the rating didn't matter. Like everybody was into this movie and kids were into this movie. You take your kids to this movie. You know, this was kind of like its own weird thing.
I think because people had seen the first one and sort of made a determination. I mean, the other thing, though, Brian, is that a movie like this would not be rated R today. It would be rated PG-13.
Right, right.
Like, we just don't... I mean, we've talked about this before. There just are not as many R-rated movies anymore.
Right. For business purposes.
Yeah, because what you're seeing is the smaller budget stuff getting squeezed out. Like, let me put it this way. This, Brian, would be like a Netflix movie today.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah. You know? And that's what's sort of crazy. I mean, now we've moved into the only movies, huge movies that can come out are things that are like proven.
Yes.
You know, or on paper, like, you know, they're going to make a certain amount of money. And what's interesting is I was reading with Warner Brothers looking to their future. They said, you know, we're investing in The Matrix again. Like, they're going to bring The Matrix back because that is a proven...
It's an IP. People know.
It's an IP. It's a franchise, you know. And it's funny that, well, you wouldn't have had that if someone hadn't taken a risk on a weird idea mm-hmm. that, like, actors were turning down because it was too weird.
Right.
You know, and so it's sort of sad we don't, we're, you know, the IP, like, are we done with new exciting IP? Every now and then something slips through, but it doesn't have the opportunity like it used to 20 years ago.
Yeah. I mean, the industry is, I mean, it's just, it's driven by blockbusters now.
Yeah. But speaking of the tropes, by the way, there is no spoon.
There is
no
spoon.
I literally, I think I said that this week. Yeah. That's great.
See, I think, you know, we were talking about Will Smith versus Keanu Reeves. I mean, I think you needed a Keanu Reeves because he conveys sort of a blank slate.
Yeah. Yes.
You know, I mean, Will Smith had an established persona.
Yes.
And in fact, you know what's funny is I remember watching this opening night and they had a trailer for Wild Wild West in front of it.
Which is what he did instead of this.
Instead of this.
Yeah.
And that movie pretty much draws on the Will Smith persona.
Mm-hmm.
You know, which was a very specific thing. So it's, you know, I think everything happens for a reason. I think everything happened with this movie exactly what needed to happen. And I think Will Smith has even said as much. Like, it wouldn't have been as good with me in it, you know?
Yeah, he very recently came out with a video saying that.
Yeah.
It's funny you say that everything happened the way it was supposed to happen as we're watching The Oracle.
Totally by chance.
Which, by the way, I remember feeling anticipation the first time I watched this, when, like, we're going to see The Oracle. Oh, The Oracle.
Yeah, what's she going to say?
So I'm like, well, what? Is she going to be, like, a creature? Is she going to be... I remember feeling, what's it going to be like? And it's so disarming then, like, no, it's just this kindly old woman in a kitchen making cookies.
And Brian, again, just going back to what I said earlier, look at the fact that the Oracle is an African-American woman.
Yeah, this is a... I mean, just even on the Nebuchadnezzar, it's a pretty diverse cast, which... In hindsight, you know, feels progressive.
Very, very much so, you know.
Yeah.
Very much so. And even, like, when we go to Zion in the sequels, I mean, you see a lot of brown.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was, there was a lot of foresight there because on that level, you know, the people running the city are people of color and stuff. This is sort of a forerunner of where we're at now, where we tend to see much more diversity on screen.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
True. I don't know that I've seen it called out for that. I'm sure somewhere.
I can't imagine. I'm the only one who said it, yeah.
Yeah, 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 yeah. But it's like, I don't feel like that's something that gets, like, associated with it.
Yeah.
But yeah, yeah, this is just, again, so against what I was expecting, you know. He's just like, oh, this woman checking in his ears and mouth out. And like, eh. You know? Like, he expects something in the shadows or at the Oracle. You know, it's another thing. I was looking at her phone book on top of her refrigerator. It just says City Phone on it.
Hmm.
And apparently when you look at his paperwork earlier in the film, where he's from, it's like Capital City, USA. And those sorts of things.
That's
I just love that. Like, how it's so not on the nose how generic they tried to make the real world appear.
That's, I didn't even
and
notice
it,
that.
We sense it.
City Phone. I'm looking at it now for the first time. I've seen this movie dozens of times. It's the first time I'm noticing that.
Yeah.
City Phone. How funny.
Yeah. They do such a, I mean, without, like I said, like, calling attention to it, they make the real world feel flat and generic. You know?
It's, you know, the Wachowskis, who are from Chicago, they gave the city Chicago street names.
Yeah, yeah. I remember that later when they're like, you know, turn on Wabash and Lake.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I remember watching it being like, hey, you know,
yeah.
Like, it's very obvious. But I think the fact that they shot in Sydney, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, to me, it's like whenever I see a movie shot in Australia that's meant to be an American city, just reflexively, I'm like, that's not America.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
There's just something about it. And so I like that it adds this disconnect where it's like they're saying Chicago street names, but it's clearly not Chicago. That adds to the artificiality of the whole thing.
Yeah, I mean, especially being, you know, U.S. citizens, it's when I see Chicago, I know the Sears Tower. When I see New York, I know the Empire State Building.
That's right.
As they're saying Chicago things, I don't see any discernible, recognizable buildings to my eye. So there's something kind of fun.
I mean, Brian, that was a thing. I mean, this is a tangent, but like Superman Returns, Bryan Singer's Superman Returns, which is a beautiful looking movie.
Right.
He shot it in Sydney, and so Sydney is meant to be Metropolis. And you watch that movie, you're like, that's not Metropolis.
Right.
You know, because when you compare it to like Richard Donner, you can tell he shot it in New York.
Right. Yeah. You know?
But I think it works in this context because it's adding to this sense of just something's off. Something's just slightly off.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, now, can you help me here with the Oracle? Now, she's saying he's not the one.
Yes.
So what is she trying to tell him?
She's essentially trying to get him. She you know, because Morpheus tells him later, she told you, like, whatever you need to hear, whatever you needed to mm-hmm. hear, right? So she needed, you know, this. Okay, so the whole series ultimately is about this notion of choice versus predestination.
Uh-huh.
Right? And so the paradox of human existence, certainly if you subscribe to a religious mindset, which includes predestination, it's like how do we reconcile choice and predestination? How mm-hmm. do we square those two? Right?
Yeah.
Did I lose you?
No. I was hoping you weren't asking me. I was like, I'm following.
I mean, it's like this, right? I mean, this is a Muslim worldview. I'm fairly certain this is the worldview for you, right? Everything that's going to happen has been written for us.
Uh-huh.
However much money we're going to get, however, you know, our entire life is written. And yet we go through life making choices.
I see. Yeah.
Right. How do we reconcile that? And it's simply because, well, we don't know what's been written. So in our mind, we're making our choices based on whatever information we have, and whatever's going to happen will happen.
Right.
So that's essentially what the Oracle is saying, right? Because as soon as you're like, oh, I'm the one. You know, I mean, that's that. Then you're assigning deification to yourself, and that she wants him to make his choices.
Yes,
as if he's not the one,
which makes sense. But with the whole bumping the vase.
Yes, exactly.
You know, saying, "Well, did you do it because you knew you're going to do it, or you know, like all this, all this choice sort of."
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Right, by the way, we should call it the glitch in the matrix here. That's another thing.
That's a thing I say all the time.
Yeah.
Whenever I have deja vu, glitch in the matrix.
Yeah, yeah.
In the third film, right, Agent Smith, he absorbs the Oracle. And so he sees the future. So he sees what's going to happen. He sees himself killing Neo.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's fighting him. Neo keeps fighting him. And he's like, why? Why do you fight? Why do you persist?
Mm-hmm.
And Neo says, because I choose to.
Yeah.
Right? And so his choice is what saves the Matrix. So Smith saw the future, but he didn't see the result of Neo's choice.
Man, this is making me feel like after this, I'm going to just keep going.
Yeah, you know, I think you should. I hope people listening to this who are, you know, sort of cold on those sequels, I really hope they give them a chance because there's so much interesting stuff happening there. And I really feel like the Wachowskis sort of put one over on Warner Brothers.
What do you mean?
With those sequels because they were, you know, I think Warner Brothers was expecting another Star Wars. And that's not, they had no interest in making that movie.
Right.
And, you know, in Matrix Reloaded, it's like a 10-minute scene where the Oracle is just saying nonsense to Neo.
Right.
And I had to watch that scene with the titles on and I had to watch it like 3 times just to understand what he was saying. But once you figure out
the architect.
Sorry, not the Oracle, the architect. Once you understand what the architect is saying, that's like the Rosetta Stone for everything.
Hmm. Well, and I'm sure every single audience opening day was not prepared for that scene.
No, at all.
Yeah.
And I remember, I mean, just speaking for myself, I'm not even like, oh, I knew all along. I watched it opening night, midnight. I fell asleep in the middle. I slept through Monica Bellucci. Like, I didn't even know she was in the movie.
Really?
I was like, hey, where was she? You know?
Yeah, that's funny.
And so it took watching it on DVD a couple of years later to really get a hang of it.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember that, thinking like, all right. Like, at some point, you're like, okay, I've completely lost what he's saying here.
Yeah.
But there's something sort of hypnotic about it and fun.
Didn't they want Sean Connery for that role?
I read that somewhere, yeah. Because there was a rumor that they wanted him for Morpheus, but it was really the architect.
That which makes more sense.
Yeah. This is a cool shot, by the way, them crawling through that wall.
Oh, it's
and the
great.
Whole frame is black except for the center.
Yeah.
It's great.
And when you think about it, it's really brilliant, because the Oracle is like, A, you're not the you're not the one, and B, it's a shame that Morpheus, you know, has to die for his belief or whatever. Well, mm-hmm. now we're invested in, like, we're convinced Morpheus is going to die.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so the movie does a nice job of, you know, if we look at what the Oracle was doing, she was setting Neo up to eventually claim his destiny and not just simply take it as a given.
Right.
So the fact that he assumes he's not the one is what leads him down this path of mounting this rescue and everything else, and then that's what ultimately makes him the one.
See, that's why you come to these commentaries. You get Zachy explaining all this stuff to you. Everything that felt like was at your fingertips and you just couldn't quite grab onto it. Well, hold on. Clutch it now.
This scene is great, where she like pulls him and you see the wall like collapsing from the outside. You see it, you know?
Yeah, I was reading, this was the last thing they shot, I guess.
Oh, really?
The walls here, yeah. And then, right there. When I was talking about, yeah, that's cool. When Morpheus is talking about the fighting styles, this is the scene I was thinking of when he's in that bathroom. Mm-hmm. It just feels brutal.
It's just, it's not balletic.
Yes, yeah. But it's like completely still heightened and still completely believable that, you know, Lawrence Fishburne is doing this and owning that guy.
Yeah, I mean, I think Fishburne has a specific physicality that plays really well.
Yeah. We meet at last.
See, I love just watching Hugo Weaving act in any movie he does.
Yeah.
He's one of these actors who just, he gives, you know, even, like, I remember him talking about, like, oh, I didn't really, like, have a good time making Captain America, whatever. And I'm like, you know what? He brought it in that movie. Even if he didn't care.
Right.
He was fun to watch, you know?
I'm trying to think, there was a, I'll have to look back here. There's some movie that I saw him in that was very, very small. And he was really good at, Oranges and Sunshine.
Okay.
And, I'm used to seeing him be these sort of villain types, you know, in these bigger movies, but he plays just like a regular guy who's been through a horrifying experience and kind of coming to terms with it. And at the end of the movie, he kind of cries. And I started crying just because I'm not used to seeing him like that.
Wow.
And so it was like almost more powerful, like seeing him as this sort of fragile person, you know, I don't know. Yeah. And I was like, man, you kind of forget, but Hugo Weaving is such an underutilized actor.
He really is. I mean, it says something that, like, he just got fed up with Michael Bay, you know, because he was the voice of Megatron in those Transformers movies.
Oh, right. Yeah, yeah.
And it's really, like, he's got such a distinctive voice, but they just kind of distorted it and did all this stuff. And it's like, well, anybody could do that.
Yeah, yeah,
like,
yeah.
If you've got access to Hugo Weaving, why not do something interesting?
Yep.
And take advantage of his presence, you know?
Yeah. Or if you're Michael Bay, you go, why would I do that?
Touche. That's true.
It's kind of interesting to think of the Wachowskis' career.
Yes.
Also, because this, I mean, obviously this is what they will always be known for. But, you know, it feels like, I don't know, they're not putting out the sort of, well, I was about to say the word crowd pleaser, but it's, I'm getting tripped up in my own thoughts here. But that's, as you're saying, with this movie. That's never what they were aiming to do with this series necessarily. Like with this, they had their own agenda.
This one is very much a crowd pleaser.
Yes, but the series as a whole, like the Matrix legacy, is just something interesting they wanted to do in the guise of an action movie.
That's exactly right. Yeah,
and but I have liked a lot of their other stuff. I liked I liked Cloud Atlas. Did you like that movie?
I did like it. Yeah, I appreciated it.
Yeah, yeah. And then Speed Racer. I know that comes up on a lot of lists of 10 underrated movies. You should that give one, a shot.
That one. I mean, I think it's eye candy, but I don't think it's a good movie.
Actually, yeah, because I watched it for that reason, and I didn't connect with it.
No, yeah. I hear it all the time, like people slept on this one. I'm like, no.
Yeah, it is beautiful, and I would love to drop acid and watch it on a big screen someday.
Yes.
But,
it's a great, you know, watch it on mute, you know? I mean, it's fantastic, yeah. But it's not a very good movie.
Yeah.
And it is a shame that the Wachowskis are, I mean, they're basically done at this point, insofar as being able to make movies on this scale.
Yes. I don't think they'll be handed a budget.
No.
Like this or larger anytime soon. And I do wonder what their involvement would be with any future Matrix installments. So if they're like, nah, we're good. Like, we're just going to take this sort of lore and
that's a question.
It.
I mean, to some extent, I view the Matrix trilogy the same way I view George Lucas's Star Wars, where it's like that, like or dislike those movies with all their various idiosyncrasies, they are a product of this person's imagination, and that is distinct.
Yep. And when you strip it from whatever that inflection they have is, you feel it.
Yeah, right. So you can easily see the you know, the quote unquote the Disney version of the Matrix, you know, like you know, like it'll be the Star Wars sequels now, where it's like, this is the stuff that this is the way we saw it, you know, all the people who
the people who grew up watching it,
yeah,
retelling it through their own experience.
I think the Matrix is a very interesting thing because it was never meant to be just those three films. The story was meant to be something that you experienced through the Animatrix, through the video game. There's a video game called Enter the Matrix. Through the comic stories. Like, it was truly meant to be something that told itself through multiple media. And imbibing all of those would be the thing that gives you a full understanding of it. Again, as I said earlier, this film, our concept of the Matrix is filtered through Morpheus's specific worldview.
Yep.
And it stands to reason, if that's all you're seeing, that's the only way you're going to perceive it. The Wachowskis wanted something bigger. Even after the trilogy ended, there was the Matrix Online, which...
Yeah.
And that carried the story forward.
Yeah.
So that's all, like, Matrix canon.
Yep.
You know?
So, is that, like, the first time that had really happened, this sort of multimedia deluge or whatever, you know, like...
Yeah, it feels like it.
And people were like, oh, I'm supposed to buy this extra DVD with all these, you know, animated things on it? Okay.
Yeah.
You know? To supplement my experience? Because, I mean, now that... I don't feel like that happens a ton, but it's something we're not unfamiliar with.
I mean, I think to some extent you look at, like, the MCU and you say, well, they kind of figured out how to tell one story over multiple formats. They just did it all through different movies, different franchises.
Right.
But I think that's the problem, is I don't think people want to do that. I think people, like, that's what I'm saying. I think Marvel figured that out. Like, if we're going to tell the story, it's got to be on screen.
Yeah, where everybody's already going. They're not going to step foot in a store they don't normally go into. Yeah. I.e. a comic book shop for certain people to read why. Yeah.
Exactly.
To find out what happened to this person.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I think that expecting people to buy the Animatrix was maybe a bridge too far.
Yeah. I do remember more people than you would expect digging into that. But you got to imagine, you know, like that the majority are not going to.
Yes, that's right. That's exactly right.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of wise for them. Well, this hadn't existed before, but with DVD taking off, you could add these bonus things and they would come with the package. right? I mean, sort of like Marvel did that a little bit, right? They'd have these shorts on their DVDs, and that would take place between the movies, right?
But even those shorts were not essential.
Right, right, right.
Like, to me, that's the problem, right? Is that the second Renaissance, you know, that anime short, you kind of need it. Like, that's crucial. Mm. So to just be like, oh, and watch that when you get a chance. Like, that I mean, not seeing that will change how you interpret these films.
Right.
You know?
This, by the way, the imagery we're seeing, this is sort of, I don't know if you get this, but with certain movies you watch over and over, there's like an image, you're like, oh, here we go. Like, this is where the movie just, like, the roller coaster has hit the top, and now we're just going down for the rest of the time.
Yeah.
This building. I'm just looking at Agent Smith up close now, really kind of for the first time here, noticing his sunglasses, and it's interesting. I mean, each character has their sort of distinctive sunglasses look. This is, I don't know about you, but with certain movies, you know, especially in the DVD era where you could go back to your favorite parts and watch them over and over, like this starts to feel like the movie I've seen 100 times.
Right?
This part in the building. Like, this is where the whole movie just doesn't let up.
And before we even get into the big action sequence, I really like this sequence here because, for one thing, we're pretty much expecting Morpheus to die. I mean, I don't know about you, but the first time I watched this, I was like, oh, Morpheus is going to die.
Oh, you know, I don't recall.
I was also, honestly. I mean, in like movie tropes, the mentor figure has to die so the hero can, you know. So there's a little bit of me thinking along those lines, but also because the Oracle's like, oh, yeah, it's a shame he's going to die. So you're just like, oh, well, she's the Oracle. So we know two things. Morpheus is going to die. Neo is not the one. Those are the things we know. Those are the truths.
Huh.
We know going into the final third, you know?
This, by the way, this reminds me of what I was saying earlier, where if anyone else were saying this whole monologue here, you'd probably start zoning out, but just whatever he's doing with his voice, you know, as oddly monotone as it is, it's still hypnotic and like you could continue listening to this.
I completely agree. I mean, I think what Hugo Weaving did, I mean, the choices he made creating the character are so distinct. I actually wonder, like, I mean, obviously this film does show that Smith is slightly different from the agents, the other agents, you know?
Yes.
But I wonder if his performance was so sort of all-encompassing that the Wachowskis made Smith a more central character.
Oh, yeah. So they would have been more of an organism, like three people that just keep overlapping each other's.
Yeah.
I can imagine that, yeah.
You know? And by the way, even with the sequels, I wonder if they brought him back. Because it's like, well, it wouldn't be a sequel without you, you know?
Yeah, I wonder. I wonder if he popped and it was a surprise to them.
Yeah, you know?
Yeah. It is. Well, it is funny because the other guys, the other agents, do look a lot like him, like similar hairlines, sort of facial structure, whatever.
Yeah.
And obviously they're speaking in the same similar manner to him. He just happens to pop out more.
And I do think it's kind of interesting that we see the paradigm when we play through to the sequels, the paradigm changes where when Smith and Neo have their final confrontation, it's completely inverse where Smith now is the one who wants to destroy the Matrix as it existed. Mm. And Neo is the one who's trying to protect and preserve it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. And this is all stuff that, again, I think it just rubbed people the wrong way because that's not what they were expecting.
Right.
Today it would be hashtag not my Neo.
Yeah. Oh, man, they're lucky, huh? I mean, they already heard enough of what people thought of the sequels, but can you imagine in the Twitter age?
I know. Oh, my goodness. You know?
Yeah.
See, the love story thing is I still think that's like the weakest aspect of this film. And I think their relationship, I do like seeing it grow, especially by the end, you know, when Trinity dies. I think Keanu Reeves plays it really well. I mean, he's distraught, you know, like he's lost his foundation. I think he does that really well, but it's very clunky, you know, like we were talking about earlier. It feels like, all right, well, this is the thing we got to do, You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. And because I love you.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess, you know?
I mean, we don't even get like a coquettish glance by either of them in the middle, you know, just to sort of, I mean, you know, it's fine, but it's.
Well, I mean, Trinity is not traditionally feminine for the majority of the film, right? So to see her suddenly become so vulnerable is, it's good. There's nothing wrong with it, but it does mm-hmm. feel very sort of abrupt.
Yeah.
You know? And, you know, to be honest, that's not the nature of the story. This is not the Trinity story. It's the Neo story. So we get it, you know?
Right. And I was thinking earlier, too, when they were the camera was on Morpheus's head and then it pans up to the agents talking over each other. It's just it's one of those things that sometimes you have to marvel at where, you know, movies are made with the same instruments, right? Mm. And, like, everyone gets a camera, everyone has some film, everybody has a boom mic, you know, and, and you can imagine another version of that where it just looks ridiculous, you know, and, like, silly, these grown men, like, rawr, 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 like, over each other. And
sure.
You know, but this movie, through whatever lens they're using, the lighting, just whatever sound design and tone they've made, you're just like, man, that's creepy and pretty cool. You know, it's. Yeah. I think about that sometimes. It's.
I mean,
artists. Some artists got it.
Right. I mean, it's just some people have a specific skill set where, you know, it's like Spielberg, right? Where he just looks at he knows where to put the camera to get the shot.
To make you feel, he knows what he wants you to feel, and he will make you feel it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, I think the Wachowski. I think Zack Snyder has that skill, to be honest, in terms of. How he frames shots. I've said that repeatedly.
Agreed.
You know?
Yeah.
And I think the Wachowskis absolutely have it. I mean, again, we were talking about this before. It's just, that's why it's such a shame to me that they are kind of, you know, they're just off on an island now somewhere, you know?
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
They are clearly talented. They clearly have stories to tell. And I would love to see a format that would allow, you know, some medium that would let them tell their stories. I mean, they had that show, right? Was it a Netflix show?
Sense8?
Yeah.
Yeah, which I never checked out. I kind of got lost in the mix for me.
That's kind of the problem. I mean, in the streaming age, it's like, yeah, there's way more ways of getting stuff out there. But, you know, The Matrix was a cultural moment.
Right. Right.
And I feel like we're being robbed of these cultural moments. Where The Matrix was something we all discovered at the exact same time.
Yes, yes.
Right? And it feels like we're never going to get that again.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, you can have these things that we're all in on. Like, my parents actually texted me the other day and were like, we loved Captain Marvel. And I was right. Like, I don't know how many times I can say it. I'm like, eh, I thought that one might lose them, you know, because it's
so funny. They're 20 movies deep. That's it, you know?
They're in. Yeah. They're in. Yeah, and so that's something that it seems like a majority of people culturally are at least familiar with.
Hmm.
But yes, the discovery. I think there's going to be fewer things that we all get to discover together.
And I think that, you know, you and I, we were born into a world where Star Wars already existed. But I have to feel like what society experienced with The Matrix was what it must have been like when Star Wars came out.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know?
Which is funny because I imagine someone who didn't see this in the theaters originally would be like, really? But it's like, nah, man, yeah, it was big.
Right. That's true. And I think I told you this when I showed it to my students. Like, it didn't... It wasn't a bolt from the blue like I would have hoped, you know?
Yeah, I remember when the sequel came out, being in college, and that's what everyone was talking about that day. Even teachers, we all had our tickets. You know, I don't know if that still happens, but
I had my ticket to my nap.
See,
my
brother and I actually still say this real quick. Where he's, you know what it is? It's the smell.
It's the smell.
Yeah.
See, this is. I mean, right there, they're setting Smith apart from the other agents as.
Yes.
You know, he's a self-aware program, and this idea of, like, the monotony of this artificial existence is just destroying him. I mean, that's really interesting, you know?
Yeah.
But look at how Fishburne is playing it. I mean, he looks like he's got one foot in the grave already.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that was we didn't call it out, but that is kind of a, I do remember now in the theater sort of clenching my chair when they're about to pull the thing out of the back of his head. And I was like, oh, are they going to do this?
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, here's the
this
most
is the moment.
Iconic scene of this movie.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, and again, in DVD, I'm like, I can just skip right to it.
Right.
Hotel lobby scene we're talking about, or whatever this is.
As they go into the, now see, okay. So as an action scene, it is just bananas and it is amazing. Yes. You know,
I've never seen anything like this before.
It really, like, so many imitators sprang up in its wake that it's hard to just say what an experience this was watching it.
Yeah.
This orgy of slow motion. I mean, it's like a Hong Kong style action movie, but we hadn't seen stuff like that in America.
Yeah.
At this level. But on a textual level, we've been told that everyone in the Matrix is a person, right?
Right. Yes.
So
yeah.
I mean, they are murdering these people, and what Morpheus says is, well, as long as you're in the Matrix, an agent can be anyone, so everyone is your enemy. But when you think about it, that's horrible.
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
Right. So this is what I keep telling you. It's like we're setting up a worldview in this film that the sequels are explicitly about undercutting.
Right.
You know.
Well, and I think what makes this, and it's funny because I sort of do that dance when I watch this scene in my head, because there's part of it that's just friggin' disturbing.
Yeah.
When you think about it, what these poor guards are going through, but then this is so set to the music and they look so cool and it's almost like balletic, you know what I mean? Like it's beautiful. And it's one of those things where I've seen, as time has marched on, you know, they talk about beautiful violence and they sort of condemn that in movies now, you know, not making the violence so much fun and gleeful to experience.
Yeah. I mean, I think Brian, I think it's fair to say that we wouldn't see a scene like this today.
No.
Yeah. You know, and because of that exact critique, because we live in an age where there's like massacres happening every other day. I mean, we're recording this 2 days after a guy live streamed a massacre in a mosque. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that line is just it doesn't even exist anymore between entertainment and scary real life.
Yeah. And I was going to say it's crappy, and I don't mean it's crappy just because we can't enjoy scenes like this anymore, but it's just like, it's one of those things where 20 years ago we didn't imagine this sort of thing, and then now sometimes you walk into a movie theater and some person walks in acting all weird, and you can't help but have this sort of imagery enter your head, and you're like, okay, what would I do if I do it? And it's just like,
it's really true.
It's a different world.
I mean, you know, we were talking about Columbine. That was just a few weeks after this. That was like the first time that we had really seen something like that, certainly
on that scale.
Yeah, you know. And now it's like every other, like it doesn't even warrant a mention anymore.
Yeah, and then also a scene like this that we used to like rewind and watch over and over, it has a different sort of feeling running beneath it.
Yeah, it's funny because I've been watching the movie with my kids. I've been watching this, and we're only about halfway through, and I was actually having that thought, like, yeah, I'm going to have to skip past the...
Isn't that funny? Like, the scene you probably would have, like, showcased 20 years ago.
I mean, I can totally see myself as a 10-year-old being absolutely engrossed in that scene.
Yeah.
You know, it's just a shame, but yeah.
You know, isn't it weird, too? I mean, when you think about growing up, I was just telling someone at work this. When I grew up, I had a toy Uzi.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, it wasn't... I mean, I'm sure they still sell cap guns and things like that, but I had, like, toy automatic weapons that I was running around playing with. Like, what a weird, weird thing.
Do you remember Entertech water guns?
I'm not sure.
Entertech was, like, realistic-looking water guns. So you would have, like, a rapid-fire Uzi shooting water or whatever.
No. And I don't remember that.
Yeah, I mean, Google it. Okay. And I mean, they were so realistic that like a kid got shot by a cop, you know?
Oh, yeah. You know? I mean, I've heard stories like that, but yeah. So,
that's one of those things where you're now, like as a kid, I'm like, man, I want one of those. And as an adult, as a parent, I'm like, there's no way in hell I would ever buy my son.
Yeah. Set that down. What are you doing?
Right.
Yeah. As we're watching here, the lobby blow up now, the elevator door flying off. And that's a funny shot with the... agents looking up at the water. yeah, just looking back and like behind the scenes sorts of things, and to what I was just saying about how do they sell what should look ridiculous. Yeah. Apparently, the way that they pitched this movie to Joel Silver, because they wrote the movie Assassins.
Yes,
remember that? Wasn't that Sylvester Stallone and Antonio Banderas? So they wrote
Richard
Assassins.
Donner directed that.
Oh, really? I've never seen it. Isn't it good?
No, it's not good.
Okay. Wait, well, all right. We have to call this out. This is the shot of the movie here.
Right.
This is rooftop agent.
Trinity,
he's going to shoot
help.
Neo here in a minute. And then the whole bullet time, him flying backwards. I literally did this at work. I think someone tossed something at me, and I was like, no. I'm like,
so bullet time, like, explain how it works, because I still don't get it.
Apparently, it is, Trinity, help.
Yeah.
dodge this. Okay. We have to, right?
yeah. We're just going to karaoke the movie, yeah.
Yeah, only human. Dodge this. Which apparently she says something else in other languages.
Oh, really?
I think she says only an agent.
Which is...
It makes more sense, but it sounds less cool.
Yeah, I was about to say, that's not a bad line either, you know?
Yeah. What were we saying? Sorry.
Bullet time.
Bullet time. So, yes, what I don't know how they originally were doing it when they developed it, because I was looking, and they said, you know, as early as 93, they were sort of figuring this out, but apparently they tried to employ the current methods for this movie, and it wasn't working right, and so what they ended up doing was still photography. So it was a ton of cameras taking pictures around, you know, whatever, I don't know, rotary they wanted.
Okay.
And so, I mean, when you watch the behind the scenes of that specific shot, it's literally this big green room and like 60 cameras.
Amazing.
In that sort of swooping pattern around him, which is crazy to me. It feels like you'd have to stitch that or something. I don't know.
Yeah, that's...
Like for his frames per second, I'm like, that's a lot of frames.
Huh.
But
so that's what it is. That's how they do it.
Apparently, at least for this one, the first one. Yeah.
This scene also is awesome with the Gatling gun and
yeah,
when
all the shells.
Yeah, I mean, it's you can see the influence of Hong Kong cinema here.
Yeah. All the water.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's like something John Woo would do. All that's missing is a dove.
Yes, that's right.
Right?
I'm almost surprised they didn't do that before everyone kind of, the West knew all about that, yeah.
I feel like John Woo parodied himself with Mission Impossible 2.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, you want John Woo? Yeah, I'll give you John Woo. Or maybe the biggest budget he ever had, and he's like, more doves.
Release the doves.
Or it's like that scene in this where the armory flies toward them. It's
yeah,
like, what are we gonna need? Doves. Lots of doves. Oh, but going back to Joel Silver, apparently the way they pitched it to him was they showed him, you know, they drew their inspirations from like Akira, Ghost in the Shell, and they showed him these anime movies, and they said, we want to do this for real.
Hmm.
And that's one of those things where I admire these executives and these producers when they can go, yeah, okay, I believe you. I would be like, I'm sure you do, but like I can't imagine it's gonna look like that'll look silly.
Yeah, and I mean the Wachowskis had only done Bound before this.
Apparently they had to do that. They before they could direct, they wanted to direct because they just wrote Assassins.
Okay.
And so Bound was their sort of, we'll prove we can direct the film.
Sure.
Which I've never seen.
I saw it, but I truly don't remember anything about it.
Yeah.
Except it has Joey Pants in it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And this was another thing I remember reading about where you had this helicopter stunt flying around, and apparently they got in trouble for this.
Really?
Because they're flying in airspace. They weren't supposed to be flying in.
Oh,
which is insane.
Sure.
I mean, like, now you would CGI two people at the bottom of that, but we got two real human beings dangling from a helicopter flying over Sydney.
But, you know, look at that. You look at that shot, and you're like, that looks awesome. And mm-hmm. It's because there's that part of your brain that knows it's actually two guys. I mean, it's not Keanu and Fishburne, obviously, but it's two real dudes. And I think there's something to be said about the fact that within this artificial world, it's all real people doing stuff.
Yeah. And I think Tom Cruise probably watched this in 1999 and was like, I get it now.
I know.
I have to climb the mountain.
That is my destiny. He just slowly, he stands up and he just walks towards the screen. He touches the screen.
Yeah, and walks into it, and they're always like, one guy's like, did you see that? To his neighbor, you know.
I love this part right here when the helicopter thing where he uses his Neo powers to like manipulate the thing there.
And I mean, we haven't stopped since they entered that lobby, and then we got this awesome the building blown. This is a great shot too, with her awesome. Flying on it. Yeah,
as she hits the glass. Like, yeah, that's awesome.
And Morpheus is like, yes.
Yeah, I mean,
apparently,
No, I mean, I think, you know, that the idea that, okay, now he is the one, like, I think it's so important that we as the audience not think he's the one.
Because, yeah, it's like a good little way to throw you off track with the Oracle.
Yeah, and I mean, it's, you know, the chosen one trope is, it's so tired now, but it was tired even back then to some extent. Mm-hmm. And I think it sort of, you know, we again, it gets this idea of predestination, right? Like, if Neo thought he was the one, then would he have done everything that he did? No, he chose to do this, and so he proved his destiny that he's the one anyway. And, you know, it's like,
yeah,
your head starts to hurt.
That's funny. You know, it's interesting also about this is we talked earlier about their training, and apparently all of them injured themselves.
Oh, I'm sure.
So, Carrie Ann Moss got a like an ankle injury, but she didn't tell anybody.
Oh, geez.
Because she didn't want to get fired. And, I mean, you hear a lot of stories about that, which, by the way, I can completely imagine. I mean, it's not wise, but I can imagine myself doing the same thing. Because, I mean, getting cast in a movie, period, is like winning a lottery ticket.
So yeah, well, didn't, was it Annette Bening? No. It was Sean Young, who was going to be Vicky Vale.
Yeah, Batman.
Right, and then she broke her arm.
Yep.
Annette Bening was Catwoman. She was originally cast as Catwoman.
Okay. Did she get injured too?
No, she got pregnant.
Okay.
So.
Man, yeah. I mean, that'd be. Yeah. Imagine you're working so hard and you, after working so hard, and then hurting yourself and being like, "Are you kidding me?"
And that's the worst.
Yeah, but apparently Keanu Reeves got a neck injury.
Oh man.
And then there was one other that I cannot recall. Oh, Agent Smith. Thank you, perfectly timed scene I'm looking at. he had to have like leg surgery, so I guess they pushed all the action and fight sequences toward the end.
Good
for
Lord.
That reason. And then Vulture actually recently had a interesting article with the lead stunt person for Neo.
Okay.
His name Chad Stahelski.
Okay.
Or Stahelski, and he they wanted him because he was really good at martial arts, but he was committed to a television show and couldn't do it.
Okay.
And then because of all these injuries and them pushing everything, he was able to do it.
Oh.
And apparently, I mean, he's a key component to being, you know, he's a lot of, you know, what we're seeing in some
he's Keanu Reeves'
fantastical stuff. Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
But this scene's a good scene to talk about it. But in his interview, he said, you know, in a lot of ways, people think of, you know, the visuals and whatnot about how this shaped action movies to come. But even more than that, you think of the fight sequences.
Yeah.
I mean, he was saying it used to be Schwarzenegger and a gun and blasting through a door. But this was like extended fight choreography.
Yeah.
And you even look at the Marvel films now. I mean, we look at like Black Widow or, you know, Captain America and his shield. Like, we have these extensive creative fights where they're using their environments. You know, and we're watching them.
You know, for sure. I mean, I think that when you look at what the Russo brothers did on The Winter Soldier, for example, I have no doubt that they were influenced by The Matrix.
That's in my memory. That's the first one that pops out at me, actually. I remember thinking that watching that movie.
Yeah, I mean, the opening action sequence is Captain America on the boat.
That's the scene I was thinking of. Yes.
Yeah, and I think I'm fairly certain there's a Matrix influence.
Because previously, you probably would have just cut to the guard and then seen him get hit by the shield and Cap pick it up and then he moves on.
Right.
But it's like, no, let's watch him fly, you know, fly down, roll over, hide, hit him, catch the shield, see the next guy. Like, it's uninterrupted and creative. It's storytelling through fight.
Exactly. And it's part of the lineage because there's much more intermingling of CG and practical in like a Marvel movie than you have here. But it's a progression.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. And I mean, look how far it's been pushed lately. I mean, when you have like the John Wick films.
Oh, sure.
You know, and Atomic Blonde. I mean, those, we go to those because we know we're going to see these really elaborate, extensive, you know, grounded, in quotes, but still more real. You know, they're using refrigerators and whatever's available next to them.
Yeah.
To take out their, the
bag. I mean, you know, it goes to, like, Jackie Chan's whole approach, right? Where he's like, I don't think of it as a fight scene. I think of it like a dance.
Right.
And, you know, his inspiration is like Fred Astaire. And when you look at how Jackie Chan choreographs fights, it's that idea of make use of the space to draw the audience in.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you know, I mean, you know, you can watch like Rumble in the Bronx and just watch it on mute and just sort of rejoice in how clever Jackie Chan is.
Yeah.
And I just think that goes to something about how we plug in to these types of things. You know, we reflexively, I'm not going to speak in broad terms, but certainly for me, when I see it's two cartoon characters like throwing fists at each other, I'm like, all right, check out.
Yeah.
You know,
except like, for the burly brawl. I mean, it's flawless.
Whoa, deja vu. But like, you know, the third act of Black Panther, where it's like Killmonger and Black Panther just going at it.
Yeah.
And they're you know, they're twisting and turning in the air. And I'm like, well, I know that's not real, you know?
Yeah, yeah. So you lose a little bit of the tension.
I want you to drop Michael B. Jordan and Chadwick Boseman off a cliff, put a camera on it. That's.
We have the technology now.
Let's get that shit for real, you know?
Boseman?
Now, this is the. I think the smart thing that they've done is they've set up the stakes where, you know, again, they've already laid out in the story, like, if you die in the Matrix, you die for real. Like, they've given you all the, you know, the pieces of information you need to actually feel invested in this.
Yeah.
You know, there's no reboot button if you die.
It's the sound of inevitability.
And this, like right here, right? Yeah, where he says, my name is Neo. Like, that's the moment. That's where he claims his destiny.
Yeah, you brought that up during the Captain Marvel thing. I totally forgot about that, but yeah. He's not Mr. Anderson.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, only the Cypher character is apparently the only one you hear his, the only other person you hear their real name. Calls him Mr. Regan or Reagan or something.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
That's, I didn't even think about that. That's right.
You know, it's funny, too, after watching this extended fight thing here also in this subway stand, I was reading that this is the only movie where Keanu Reeves handles firearms. Neo, I should say.
Because he, after this, at the end of this movie, he's transcended.
Yeah, he doesn't need it.
He doesn't need it, you know?
He can stop bullets.
Yeah, and if you notice, like, what he wears in number two is, like, kind of priest-like.
Oh, yeah.
You know? He's like a warrior monk, the way he dresses.
Which is badass. It's funny, because when you said, you'll notice how he dresses, in my head I was thinking, since he is so relaxed and can do this now,
yeah,
I was picturing it'd be, like, more easygoing, and I was picturing him in, like, a Hawaiian shirt and flip-flops. And that's, like, a whole other direction this movie could have gone if it were made in the 80s.
You know what's funny is I remember, speaking of a whole other direction, I remember reading, like, Harry Knowles' review of the second one. And
how did that go?
Well, yeah, I mean, just, you can sort of imagine. But there was, he got it into his head that, like, the Matrix is why we have myths about werewolves and vampires and stuff like that. And he's like, I wanted Neo to fight werewolves and vampires.
Oh, right.
Where were the werewolves and where are the fudgicles, you know? And I'm like, no, that sounds terrible. Like,
yeah.
I don't want to see that.
First of all, Harry, it's pronounced fudge sickle. And second of all, that's not what we signed up for with this computer action thriller.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, I love this. I love this stuff.
I mean,
this actually reminds me of... what's that?
The tension here is so... I mean, it's like pulled tight like a cord, you know?
Yeah, this is some like badass shaky cam, by the way.
Yeah.
Like, good shaky cam. I can tell what's going on, but I'm feeling nervous. I love this stuff. Like,
that's right there,
woman,
with the knife.
Old woman with knife. Turn around. Agent with knife. This is great. Right. It reminds me of, it's in Terminator 2, you know, when that security guard is walking down the hallway and the camera just looks up and looks back down and it's the T-1000. I'm like, I don't know how, but that's even better than a visual effect. It's like scarier in a weird way.
I mean, if you can find a way to do it in camera, you know?
Yeah.
You know, it's like you were saying earlier, like the percentage of actual digital effects in the digital effects in this is relatively low.
Which I always forget about the Sentinels in this movie.
Yes.
They're a component they're fine. And it's funny, I've never really connected to them as things in this movie. And when they show up, I tend to be like, I want to move on from this. Hmm. And I wonder if that is because they're like CGI creations in this otherwise tactile sort of universe.
That's a good point. I mean, it's kind of funny how we're more invested in the fake world than in the real world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, this right now with Neo running through the Matrix is where that's what we're really hooked into. And then the stuff with the Sentinels feels like it's like added tension.
Yeah. I mean, it's good. You need it to know that we could lose everything in Zion.
It's, you know, the conversations I've had with people about this film, people who don't like what came after, like, oh, I wish it was just one movie. And when you think about it, like, had they never done another Matrix, had they never done anything after this, I mean, yeah, you've got a pretty compelling one and done.
Yeah. Yeah. We were just talking about that. I forget what we were saying. Oh, Alita, Battle Angel. We were saying it's great that they want to do sequels, and I would happily watch one, but the first one, you know, Matrix, Star Wars, like, you need a satisfying film first.
Yes.
To make us want a sequel.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Look at that. That's great.
This is good. I mean, this is, you don't know, the rules are so crazy in this movie. Like, I don't know what this means the first time I'm watching it. And it's just been shot.
That's the beauty of, again, I go back to that experience being in the theater opening night where you're like, you have no idea what's going to happen. So here you're like, is that what? Is that it? Is that it? He's dead? You know?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I mean, this looks bad.
Doesn't look good.
Yeah.
Look at that.
This is great, though. I like this shot with Trinity, with him at the chair, and you got the sparks in the background and everything.
So here's the question. Yeah. The rules are that if you die in the Matrix, you die in the real world. He has clearly died in the Matrix.
Mm-hmm.
What brings him back? Please don't
like,
tell
me. Like, is it literally her love?
Yeah, I was about to say, don't tell me it's the power of love, because that's some horse shit right there.
I don't know, it might be. To the Wachowskis, right? Maybe they're like, hey.
I mean, you look at him, he is an ex-Neo. He's... He's joined the choir, you know?
Or maybe it is because he's the one and, you know, the Oracle told her she would love him or whatever it is. And so it's satisfying for her. It's also us, it being confirmed to us that it's because he's special.
Yeah, whatever. This is the part where my students were kind of chuckling.
It is very corny in a movie that hasn't been corny yet.
Yes, it's noticeably, right, exactly. It's a little squishy.
Yeah. Squishy. That's good. I love that though, the sparks behind her. That looks really cool.
See, again, it's, to me, I'm drawn to the fact that they look so similar.
I can't believe I've never thought about that.
I mean, am I wrong? You know, I mean,
no, they totally do. Yeah.
Right. I mean, they both seem kind of androgynous. She's a little more masculine. He's a little more feminine.
Right.
I mean, Keanu Reeves has always had these very soft features. And, you know, I think that's like what makes John Wick so interesting is he's this total hard case.
Right.
Who's played by Keanu Reeves.
Right.
You know?
But, you know, I do buy him as a badass.
No, I do. But, I mean I think that's what makes John Wick unique. That's what I mean.
Oh, I see.
Because he doesn't look like your traditional... You know, he's got a wiry frame. He's, you know what I mean?
Oh, sure. Yeah, I mean, like when you picture Speed or something, like you can imagine that being so close to the early 90s, that being Schwarzenegger.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like Speed, you could see, like, you know, Bruce Willis doing that.
Yes.
You know,
yeah.
And granted, that's like it's like a diehard ripoff anyway, right? But Keanu Reeves, I mean, I remember Speed being a switch for Keanu Reeves.
Yes. That's how I remember it in my head, too, because I think I was too young for Point Break. But
right.
Yeah, and then now these days too, we have these more everyday man or everyman action heroes.
Yes.
Kind of thing.
This, I love this. Look at that.
Yeah.
This he doesn't is, even yeah. care.
So satisfying. And when he looks down the hallway and sees nothing but numbers. And,
I know.
Actually, dude, we say that on the show all the time. I would say when a movie doesn't work for me, I'm like, well, I can see all the ones
we can
zeros.
See the code.
I can see the code.
We really have internalized this movie in a big way. Like,
yeah, way more than I think about, but it just is.
I mean, it changed the language of cinema.
Mm-hmm.
And it's weird to me that given the sort of the size of the impact crater that it left, like it isn't talked about as much today.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. But I think, especially rewatching it now, I think it entirely holds up.
No, I agree with you.
That's great. And bending the world. just one more thing I had written down that I hadn't covered yet, I forgot. But speaking of exposition and having to explain all your stuff in this movie, in the first 45 minutes of this film, it says Neo has 80 lines, and 44 of these lines are questions. Isn't that interesting?
So literally half his dialogue is him like, what the hell's going on?
Yeah, yeah. Well, what about this? Da, 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 da. And
see,
you know, the fact
now
that I didn't
Mark
even
Wahlberg
notice that.
Was Neo, just so it could be, what are we going to do this?
Mark, that
how'd you jump across the building?
You were going to try to stop us, Mr. Anderson? No. What are you talking about? Or whatever that line is from The Happening. No.
What? No.
Yeah.
True love.
Yeah. But yeah, the fact that I've never even noticed that half of the things he's saying are questions in the first half, that's credit to this movie and Keanu Reeves.
Like I said, I was watching it with the boys yesterday, and we're like halfway through. So we're up to when Neo is training with Morpheus. And my oldest is 12. I mean, he's keeping up with it. He gets it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So all of that is so important to just you lay out all the rules, and you essentially make Neo a surrogate for the audience, so that the back half we're just 100% on board.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
This I love this ending here.
Yeah, it's a good ending, and you're like, wait, Neo can fly?
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
like when he hangs up, and then the cutting, the music, the dun 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 dun.
Yeah,
I can hear it. We're watching it on mute. I can totally hear it.
Mm-hmm.
And they play like Rage Against the Machine at the end.
Yeah,
which of course they do. See, you know, I'll tell you that what's sort of infuriating to me is how the iconography and inner language of this film and these films has been taken over by like folks on the alt right.
Really?
And they call themselves red pills, and they're like, we're surrounded by a bunch of blue pills and all this stuff. And I'm like, you guys, like the Wachowskis would kick all you guys in the balls for what you guys are doing to the Matrix's. Inner language.
Sometimes I feel so lucky to be out of the loop of these such things.
Yeah, you're not wrong. Yeah, I mean, it's like, talk about a total misreading of what this movie is about.
Yeah.
You know?
Man, I just had a blast just watching it on silent here.
I know. Exactly.
You know? I saw this quote, because I was trying to read up a bunch about it, and like I said, Vulture has been writing pieces on it lately, and I thought this quote was pretty fitting by Emily Yoshida. She said, "The Matrix, for all its plugged-in technological themes, was the rarest of creatures. Its value was in and of itself, and there was no external algorithm through which it derived its value. Nobody was obligated to see it because of another movie that came before. They saw it because it looked cool, and then they saw it again because it was cool."
That is the perfect summation.
Right?
Yeah.
I long for another movie like that. Something that we see because it looks cool, and then we see it again because it is cool.
Yeah. It's hard to think of anything since The Matrix that was a brand new IP that had the kind of impact that The Matrix did.
Yeah.
You know? But I appreciated the chance to sort of dive back into, you know, into the mists of nostalgia with you. This is I as far as I know, you and I have never watched this movie together.
No, I don't think so. But it's funny because I'm sure that we, you know, have spoken the whatever it's put into our brains. You know what I mean? Have you noticed that actually? It's like a lot of the stuff from this movie has sort of been regurgitated culturally through us. Like, you know, when you see something and it looks weird, you say it's like a glitch in the Matrix.
Yeah. Like, didn't we just talk about that? Deja vu.
That was a joke we tried to set up. I don't know if that worked. I'm sorry. I don't know if I sold that well enough.
So Jeffrey Darrow, you just saw, conceptual artist. He's a very famous comic book artist. He worked on a comic called Hard Boiled with Frank Miller, and he did Big Guy and Rusty the Boy Robot. So there's a beautiful book that came out right around the time this film, maybe a little bit after, called The Art of the Matrix, and it's just the whole movie's storyboards.
Hmm.
And it's worth tracking down. I don't know if it's available or readily available, but it's like a comic book of the Matrix.
Oh wow!
You know, very good. And as I said earlier, I mean the mythology that the Wachowskis wove around this concept is really rich and voluminous, and it transcends just the films, and it includes again those animated shorts and there's like live action cut scenes that went to the video game, and then, you know, the world as it continued in the Matrix Online. It's something really unique and special. It is sort of, you know, on a back burner right now. It's not an active property, but as we were talking about earlier, it's something that Warner Brothers, of course, they want to see if they can bring it back.
Mm-hmm.
Reflexively, I don't want them to. I want this to just be a thing that exists, and you know, people, I kind of love that the sequels are like this indie band that nobody's discovered.
and
it's just kind of my thing. That's something that whoever does something next is, I have a feeling they will lessen the impact of these films. I mean, we've this is not our first rodeo. We've seen whenever you bring back an old IP, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But nothing, regardless of what you think of the sequels or anything else, whether you know about the sequels or you care about the sequels, whatever, nothing will change the singular achievement of this film specifically.
Completely agree.
Yeah. And I think that's a good place to leave this conversation. What do you think?
This has been fun.
This has been fun. Keanu Fest 2019 is not over yet because this is the 25th anniversary of Speed. So you can rest assured we will be doing a commentary track to celebrate that movie.
I love that movie.
I'm really looking forward to talking about that with you. So that's coming up soon. And as far as our next commentary track after this one, it's going to be The Karate Kid, which celebrates its 35th anniversary this year.
Oh, man. That's a movie that's been there for most I can remember of my life.
That's another one I'm very much looking forward to. Did you see the trailer, by the way, for Cobra Kai Season 2?
Oh, no, I haven't.
Oh, I'm just like, plug, find a vein and plug it in. My body is ready. You know?
Yeah.
But speaking of plugging in, we're about to plug out because it's time to go. If you have any questions or thoughts about this commentary, please, as I say each and every time, email us at moviefilmpodcast@gmail.com, or you can message us at facebook.com/moviefilmpodcast. Also, please hit like on that page. If you're looking for me online, you can go to my website, zakiescorner.com, that's Z-A-K-I-S corner, where in my archives you can see my review from 20 years ago that I wrote for The Matrix for the College of DuPage Courier. It is posted in my blog movie review archives. So,
holy cow, I want to read that.
Yeah, I think the last thing I say is, like, bring on The Matrix 2 or something like that, which is like, in hindsight, ironic because so many people hated the sequel. But check that out. And of course, you can find me on Twitter at Zacky's Corner. Brian, where can people find you?
Writing for Puppy Dog Pals, which won't have any scenes even remotely close to what we saw in the lobby.
I'm picturing like Rolling Bingo, like, you know.
Yeah,
put the guns through the metal detector and the slow-mo on the wall. No, that's not going to happen.
Yeah, well, we'll joke.
Hey guys, it is Ryan. I'm not sure if you know this about me, but I'm a bit of a fun fanatic when I can. I like to work, but I like fun too. It's a thing. And now the truth is out there. I can tell you about my favorite place to have fun. Chumba Casino. They have hundreds of social casino style games to choose from with new games released each week. You can play for free anytime, anywhere. And each day brings a new chance to collect daily bonuses. So join me in the fun. Sign up now at ChumbaCasino.com.
No purchase necessary. VGW Group. Void where prohibited by law. See terms and conditions. 18 plus.
Hello, it is Ryan. And I was on a flight the other day playing one of my favorite social spin slot games on ChumbaCasino.com. I looked over at the person sitting next to me. And you know what they were doing? They were also playing Chumba Casino. Coincidence? I think not. Everybody's loving having fun with it. Chumba Casino is home to hundreds of casino-style games that you can play for free anytime, anywhere, even at 30,000 feet. So sign up now at ChumbaCasino.com to claim your free welcome bonus. That's ChumbaCasino.com and live the Chumba life.
No purchase necessary. VGW. Void where prohibited by law. See terms and conditions. 18 plus.